Obviously, there's a big push going on right now, right? As it should be. So, a dream last night, super significant here. So, we're going to use this dream as a way of getting into the video. Was in a house, and suddenly there was this loud noise outside, like a storm, like bam, 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 bam. And someone else in the house got up and they said, "Hey," and they went outside and they followed them outside and were looking around and there's all this damage. It some kind of ferocious turmoil had taken place and was affecting the house badly. Well, to some extent. And so they were working on repairing the house. And I was sort of helping out a little bit, but I wasn't really into it that much. I really wasn't into it. And they looked at me and they conveyed like, "Hey, I expected you to take over as boss of this job of fixing the house when I'm not around. But I'm not going to ask you because I don't think you're really into it." And then I found myself on the porch of this house. It's covered porch. And I was wondering, okay, well, what am I going to do? I'm not going to really take over being the boss of fixing this house from the turmoils that were assailing it. But I didn't really want to. That's not my purpose. Okay, now what happened is that out of nowhere, this indescribably beautiful bird appeared, a small bird, hovering right near me, like this, just hovering right in this underneath this porch. It was just there, and I was just like, wow. And then what I did was quite extraordinary. I put up my hand like this, and say to see if the bird would perch on my hand, to see if the bird would perch on my hand. And as I raised my hand up like this for the bird flew over, and it perched on my hand. But its wings kept moving. So it was perched on my hand, but it was showing that it's not attached to the world, so to speak, or my body, so to speak. It's still retaining its freedom. It was showing me I still have my freedom, but I am perched on your hand. His feet were perched on my hand. Then I said, "Well, I wonder. I want to make sure this bird is can still fly. And I don't want it to ground it in any way." And so left my perch and was hovering above me, again, hovering near me, right in front of me again. And then I extended my hand again, and it came back and it perched on my hand again. And I was just sitting there. I was just sitting here, like right now, just looking at this bird. Now, the bird was indescribably beautiful. It was similar to a hummingbird, but larger, because it could hover. It could hover like a hummingbird. The world, the bird was appeared out of nowhere and was indescribably beautiful. And yet I had the somehow it came to me to see, I want this bird to perch on my hand. And it did so. So the bird was not afraid of me. It wasn't a normal bird at all. You could call it the bird of paradise, a bird of paradise, actually. It was so. Now, my attention was taken by this bird so much that all thoughts of the house and damage to the house and the yard and all this vanished. I had no interest in any of that anymore at all. Now, Jesus says that to give is to receive. And this is something of fundamental importance to us. So what he says is that whatever we want for our brothers in spirit, for spirit, that is what we shall receive. So what I want for everyone is for everyone to lose all interest in this world and turn their attention to something that is truly precious and truly sublime and is not subject to vulnerability in any way. That's what I really want everyone to have. I don't want them to have a world. I want them to have something vastly better than a world. And so, because I want that for everyone, I received it myself. So my impression was, even if the entire world was crumbling and falling to pieces, and even if it was entirely destroyed, it wouldn't have affected me in any way. It wouldn't have affected this bird at all, and there it wouldn't have affected me at all, because I have something vastly more precious, you see. So I was undisturbed by whatever was taking place. The house symbolizes, and the yard may symbolize like the world. I had no interest in what was happening in the world. It has no interest. It didn't matter to me at all what was happening in the world, one way or the other. Whether the world comes or whether it goes made no difference to me. Whether the world's happy or sad made no difference to me. It was totally irrelevant. The world was not relevant at all. It was just the presence of this bird was what was relevant to me. I was absolutely captivated. My attention was on the presence of this bird. Bird of paradise. Maybe the Holy Spirit is often symbolized by a bird. The grace of God is symbolized by a bird, oftentimes. So, out of the blue, This bird suddenly appeared to me. It just appeared. It was there. Wow. And that was after I turned down the implied offer. Says, you know, you could take over my position as being the chief of repairing this house and this yard and taking care of all the repairs, fixing the world, in other words. And I turned it down. I said, no, I'm not geared for that, actually. On page 207 of Dialogue on Awakenings, presented by Tom and Linda Carpenter, Jesus says, Tom asks him a question, and Jesus basically says, look, just put your attention on your awakening from dreaming, from ending, letting go of your dreaming, stopping your dreaming, letting it go, awake from your dream, from your dreaming. He says, put your attention just on whatever helps you do that. Put your attention just there and don't put your attention anywhere else. He says, so don't be engaged in someone else's process at all, he says, because you will find that there are infinite processes and this will sideline you and distract you and delay you indefinitely. Only put your attention on that which serves your awakening. That's it. Nothing else. Does fixing the world serve my awakening? It doesn't serve my awakening. That's endless. Because the world is really a dream of abnormality. And if we fix the world, then we'll tear it down again. Because our purpose is to see if we can't... the world symbolizes reality to us. And so having troubles in the world symbolizes abnormal reality. Abnormality of reality. So as long as we want to dream... a dream of abnormality, which is the whole purpose of dreaming. We have to dream of abnormality because abnormality that doesn't exist in reality. So we have to have this imaginary dream. When we want to try to change reality, we have to dream. We have no choice. So it's always then a dream such that abnormality troubles arise always. So it's like Sisyphus pushing that boulder up the hill. It always just rolls back down again. Okay, always. So there's no point in trying to fix the world. Let those who want to dream of a world that has problems. Let them, that's what they will dream about. Our goal is to awaken from dreaming, and that has to be what I want for everyone, is to awaken from dreaming, not for anyone to be trying to fix a world, which only leads to more problems, which need to try to fix those, and that leads to more problems trying to fix those. That goes on and on and on and on. As long as you're dreaming, that will continue. So it's futile, Sisyphusian futility. So what I want is to, for everyone to awaken from dreaming, to give up dreaming, which means to accept that it's impossible to make reality abnormal. There can never be an absence of intrinsicness in reality. It's impossible. So because that's what I want for everyone, that's what I receive. So what you share, what you're willing to share with everyone else, is what you, the allness, which is the allness, since you are also the allness, you experience that. And if you would share abnormality with the allness, you, at least a dream of abnormality, you would experience that also, and you would have vulnerability. So it's the presence that awakens us from the dream. It distracts our divine distraction away from our interest in the dream of abnormality. And I cannot describe the beauty of this bird because it was ever-changing. It was ever-changing, spontaneously ever-changing. It was the presence of exquisite beauty, to say the least. Spontaneous. And it was like all feathers, you know. You couldn't really discern fleshiness of a bird. I kind of like that about birds. You couldn't discern. It just seemed to be these beautiful feathers and the wings and this little feet that perched on my hand. There was no corpulent fleshiness about the bird. And it was buoyant, you know, it was so buoyant in the air. It was like, it was, yes, its wings were there, but these wings seemed to be just expressing beauty. And it seemed like it could just float beautifully in the air, but also it could also land and perch on my hand without losing its buoyancy. So it's really very Holy Spirit-like, isn't it? A bridge, right, between dreaming and awakening. A bridge between dreaming and awakening. So this new way practice is certainly showing fruits already, very, very extraordinary fruits here. And that is, I can do nothing. I can do nothing. There's nothing that I can do. There's nothing that I can do, devaluing the I to the ultimate extent. There's nothing that I can do. There's nothing that I can control. There's nothing that I can do. I can't fix anything. I can't fix anything. I cannot fix anything. This humility and concerning the I, which is really our belief that we can create abnormal absence, the presence of absence of reality, of presence, the presence of the absence of presence. What we're saying is we can't do that. When I say I can't do anything, means this desire to be greater than God, to change reality, that's not possible. Spirit cannot do that. And so my expectations are that I expect that I can't do it. I absolutely expect I cannot do it. And so then we're able to pivot our attention off of the world onto this exquisite bird of paradise. As long as we thinking, you know, I can do it, I can try, I can't even try to do it. I can't even try to do it in any way. I'm incapable of even trying at all. I can't even make the slightest effort to fix the world. I can't even make the slightest effort to fix the world. So it's when we have to get our attention off desiring to fix the world. And then when we do that, we pivot, our attention pivots, and out of nowhere, this bird of paradise appears for us. Out of the blue sky, it just appears. The Buddhists would certainly say this is the Sambhogakaya, the bliss vehicle. Absolutely, they would say that. So the bliss vehicle, in Buddhist terms, appeared to me in a dream and perched on my hand. But whatever you call it, that's our aim. Okay, so we want to pivot off of trying to fix. I can't even try to fix anything. I can't even try. I can't even muster the slightest effort to fix anything. Okay? Keep in mind, the reality doesn't have anything to fix. At all. So to say that I have even the slightest desire to fix something means I want to dream a dream of vulnerability. Okay? That's what it really means. And that I want all of spirit, the allness, to also dream a dream of vulnerability. But when I say I can't even muster the slightest effort to try to fix anything at all, I'm saying that's what I want for everyone, and therefore the allness, and therefore that's what I receive, and that really then devalues dreaming altogether. Totally, because dreaming has to be a dream of vulnerability, really. It has to start out as that. Does it not? Because there's no vulnerability in reality at all. No vulnerability to being abnormal at all. So I can't even muster the slightest effort to try and fix anything. I have no motivation to fix anything at all. So this is how we pivot our mind. Now, I came back from the desert and back up to the Silicon Valley, Bay Area, San Francisco Bay Area here, Silicon Valley, South Bay. And I didn't want to come back here. I said, man, I'd rather just die than come back here, you know, really. But I said, no, the Holy Spirit said, no, you have to go back. I said, okay, but, and the Holy Spirit said, don't worry, you won't stay. But just, you do have to go back. I said, okay, I'll stay for a while, and I'll work, I'll keep working. I understand that I have to do this. But boy, did I not want to do that. And so, I got up here, and all the bad habits started to come back that I worked so hard to prepare. I knew I was going to leave here for a while, so I prepared to where I was going to. I wanted to make sure that I was able to leave all those bad habits behind when I left here, and I was able to. But when I came back, the bad habits here start to come back. I said, wow, this is bad. This place, you know, induces these bad habits. And so I had this dream where I started to get my attention back on bad habits, and then suddenly in my mind I said, wait a minute, I don't want to do this. And I pivoted my attention off the Silicon Valley back to the desert. And I saw this peaceful, very peaceful place without bad habits. And I said, wow, I can do this. I'm going to do that. I'm not going to try to get, you know, let the bad habits get me here. I'm going to pivot my mind. So I realized it's possible to pivot our mind off of worldly turmoil, the vast effort to fix the world, and onto peace, the peacefulness that's already present. Nothing to fix. Those who want to fix something will always find vulnerability and something to fix. Always. Never ending, right? But those who give up any desire to fix anything at all will find paradise. But there's nothing to fix. There's simply this never-ending, exquisite glory of experiencing warm morning here, very warm. You can tell it's going to be get pretty toasty. Pretty toasty here. 96 yesterday. I wouldn't be surprised if it was a little bit warmer today. Maybe 97, 98. Getting up near triple digits. But not quite. But it, you can feel it didn't cool down much last night, let's put it that way. Because there's no movement of air at all. It's just still. So, I can't even make this, I cannot muster an iota of motivation to fix anything. So, I decided I'm not going to be the hero of the world. Okay, I'm going to go for presence. Now, presence will be received by those who are humble enough to receive it. It will not be received by those who are gung-ho on fixing the world. They're saying, well, you're useless. Many say Ramaharshi said he was useless. They criticized him, saying he didn't try to help fix the world at all. He's completely useless. So many had that opinion of him. Say, so he just sat there doing nothing. That's just, what a waste. They say, what a waste of life. You know, it's terrible. And then, but there are others who say, you know, wow. They may invoke him to try to fix the world, but it doesn't seem to work, and they get frustrated. And then there are others who get it and just say, wow. But it's not an easy get for us, is it? It's not an easy get. It hasn't been an easy get for me at all. I oscillated to, like, back and forth. You say, oh yeah, this is it. And then you say, but wait a minute, how does this help the world? You know, and then you go back, well, this is it. And it's very difficult for us to recognize what's going on here. We're so baffled by this dream. By all our white lies, have believing in our white lies. So it has not been easy to get to this point for me to pivot my attention to the bird of paradise. Not at all easy. But it is very doable. If you just don't give up. Do we really need to fix a dream? Is the question. Jesus insists this world is nothing but a dream. It's just a mental projection. And in Dialogue on Awakening, he gets into these questions about the rainforest, about ecology, about all this stuff, and all the problems of this world. Global warming was not something that was talked about back in 1992, but he touched on all of this basic, you know, the ecological changes and the damage to the ecology of the world and all this, because Tom was interested in asking that. And his response was quite extraordinary. He says, what makes you think that I say that all you need to do is change your mind, how you view everything here, and you will be experience peace. He says, what makes you think that's any different for the world? Since the world is only a mental projection of your own mind, he says, so healing your mind, he says, what makes you think that won't heal the world? And he put this to Tom, and I got that. You know, I'm lucky if I say, yes, Jesus did address the ecological issue here of this world. He has addressed it, and he addressed it exactly in the way I would expect him to address it. Hallelujah. And so he very gently but firmly keeps reiterating that, look, your job is to awaken from the dream. Stop dreaming. Let go of dreaming. And you don't have anything to fix at that point. Believe me. When your mind is well, there's no sickness anywhere. There's no damaged ecology anywhere. The ecology of the world is all a projection of our mind. Everything is the mind. Nothing is outside of the mind. There's only this one mind. Nothing's outside of it. And he talks about AIDS. He talked about AIDS also, and same thing. He says, all these problems you see, you think you're trying to need to fix these problems. He said, I tell you, just heal your mind. And a healed mind means a mind that has pivoted away from dreaming. And he said, you won't have any problems to fix at all. Just do this one thing, and that's all you need to do. Now, those who don't want to do that, of course, they will still keep experiencing a problematic scenario that they think is outside of their mind. Okay. But that will continue indefinitely for them. A mind that is trying to be insane will most certainly experience all sorts of insane situations, which it seems to be external to the mind, and think that it has to apply some sort of external remedy to these situations, and will always be engrossed in that. Engrossed in it. Always be engrossed in it. You can work your entire life to fix problems in this world, and you will still be engrossed in the problems of the world, as long as your motivation is to continue to dreaming. Sisyphean task. Okay, it never ends. That task never, you will continue to be engrossed. Now Jesus says, only concern yourself with awakening, nothing else. And Thomas asking, like, you know, the problems of the world, or what, you know, what about this, this, and this, this issue, this issue, this issue? And Jesus says, look, those issues are never ending. They continue to rise and rise. As long as you want to dream, these issues will continue to arise in various guises and packaging. But he said, that doesn't concern you. Your concern is to awaken from dreaming, to give up dreaming. That's your concern. So let that be your concern, and therefore let that be the concern of everyone. Give that concern, that one concern, to all, and that will be, you will feel that is your one concern. Because all I wanted to give to everyone was spend your life focused on enlightenment and giving up dreaming. And so since I was willing to give that to everyone, that's what has been given to me. I didn't tell people, go out and solve the problems of the world. Go out and build this, do this, this. No, I said, spend your time in meditate, contemplation, consideration, focus, let your attention settle. Put yourself at the heart of answering, having these questions answered. We must get fundamental answers to our whole existential situation, all these questions. Let us focus on just that. So that's what I advised everyone and wanted for everyone. So I ended up having a life that was that. I received what I gave everyone. Now, it's not been easy by any means, because all our defenses are mutually reinforcing. So we might get clarification here, but the mutual reinforcing defenses will you know, squash it. And you say, what happened? So you have to smooth out your path and be able to go more at just out. I'm already have the answer. That sort of way, that really bypasses the defenses, and it's shocking. It shocks you, and then you have to block panic. So I found that is the way you have to actually go to in awakening. And Jesus remarks extensively in this area, confirming all of this. That he says, to awaken just tell yourself you're already awake. You're already awake. And just focus on that. I'm already awake. Wow. But that bypasses all defenses, you see. In which it then, so our expectations are shocked by this. We don't know what to expect. So then we could go into panic if we don't know how to block the shock of this. Now he says, don't worry, don't worry. Everything will be, as you go past all of this and let go, everything will be there for you. Which is true, true enough, theoretically. But from the standpoint of not knowing what to expect, we get the jitters. We get the jitters. And this is why we all, so many of us fail, Because we keep thinking that it should be easy for us, and we get the jitters and say, well, I'm not cut out for it. You know, there's something wrong with me. So that's why I emphasize this so much. There's nothing wrong with you when you get the jitters. That's what's supposed to happen when you bypass your defenses to awakening. Because you're bypassing all your expectations. And your expectations is what is the road that you're on. And suddenly, like, there's no road. You suddenly went off road. It's like, well, I don't know where I am or where I'm going. There's no road, so how do you know what your aim or destination is, right? You're suddenly in a roadless, pathless land. And you say, well, I don't know how to continue on. How do I reach my destination? So it's very shocking. You get jitters, of course. So it doesn't mean you're not cut out. It means you are cut out because you just went off road. You just went off road. Now, a lot of people in the world are going off road in a physical way with their ATVs, their four-wheel drives, their motorcycles, their mountain bikes, and all that. But they're trying to put the context into this world of going off-road. They say, yeah, I can go off-road. It's a very physical thing they're doing. I had a dream where I was mountain biking, and Jesus appeared and said, it's time for us to we're going to go along the side of the mountain. We're not going to continue up and down the mountain. So it's not, what the world's doing is not quite it. They're trying to sort of have their cake and eat it too. They say, you know, I can go off-road, but it's still something that's physically mapped out. What we're talking about is going off the road of dreaming altogether. They're still maintaining the dream. Say, yeah, I can have the dream, but go off-road within the dream, so to speak. We're talking about, I'm already awake. I'm not even dreaming of a world at all. So this is a different scenario, actually. So the world indeed is being too clever. They say, yeah, we can go off-road. This feeling like I have to go off-road. And they say, okay, we can do it. But it's in the context of this world still dreaming. Oh, a bird just showed up. Hi, bird. Maybe I'll put my hand up to perch. It didn't perch on it. But this little bird just showed up here. But it's a very dowdy bird. It's not the bird of paradise. And it flew away. And there's some more. Oh, a bunch of birds suddenly came. Small birds suddenly came at the area here. Ah. Yeah. So maybe, oh, so many, 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 many. So these are like the mountain bikers, the off-roads one. They're still worldly. Okay, they're still worldly. They're still trying to get their buzz from the world. They're still trying to fix the world, but just make it a better place, a better home, so they can feel, well, I don't need to go off-road to paradise. I can go off-road in this world. It's that kind of thing. Wow, there are many, 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 many little birds suddenly came. They're all hopping around on the branches here. But none of them will come to my hand. I'll put my hand out. Will they come perch on my hand is the question. Birds. They're earthbound. See, they're not hovering in the air, in the sky. They have to hop around in the trees. Oh, one did just a little bit right there. He says, yeah, I can do a little bit. So those are the off-roaders. Amazing synchronicity there, huh? He says, see, I can go a little. The bird kind of fluttered a little bit in the air, and then it went back to its perch. So it's kind of like having your cake and eating it too. It's trying to please both the ego, going off-road in this world, trying to please both the ego and the Holy Spirit. Trying to serve two masters. It doesn't work. So I've never been attracted to going off-road in this world, physically doing that. I've never really done that. Yeah, I've never done it. It just, I understand that that's That's not what I'm giving to everyone. I'm giving the goal of paradise, really. The truly sublime, the spontaneous exquisiteness that is not dependent on any body, really. Not vulnerable at all in any way. Now, so many people hurt themselves going off-road here, don't they? Oh, yes, they sure do. We'll just let that sit there. We've just raised that to consciousness, and I'm not going to try and go into it too much right now. I have to get used to the fact that this is an issue, isn't it? Big issue. Because so many are doing that now in the world. And they see that as their salvation. And they're engrossed in it. They're very much engrossed in it. Wow, there's a breeze, and there's a scent of jasmine on the breeze. Wow, that's wonderful. Wow. I like the summer breeze. There seems to be scents with the summer breeze. So to not be engrossed in the world going forward, we must be have our pivot our attention to presence. That's the option. Not to become more engrossed and say, well, I can go off-road and that'll settle me down. Go on a mountain bike, that'll settle me down. What will pivot? When we pivot our attention to presence, we don't even know the idea, the notion, is there a world or not a world, doesn't even arise. We're not even interested in a world at all. Now, I've never been interested in this world, actually. My feeling was always, what are you interested in this world for? It's just completely gross. People talk about our world. I said, what are you talking about, our world? It's not my world. I don't wish this world upon anyone. So I don't wish it upon myself. I'm included in everyone, right? Right, I'm not separate from everyone. So I don't wish this world upon anyone at all, including myself. I never thought this world was my world. My world? Why would I claim this world as my world? That never occurred to me. This is the ever so. This is your world. I'm like, no, it's not. It's not my world. I'm just visiting here to bring this to your attention. You know that you can. This is you deserve. Vastly better than this. Everyone does. We don't have a world. Reality isn't a world. Reality is indescribable. Cannot be defined with boundaries and limitations. We don't have a world. We have the allness. The unbounded, unlimited, indescribable isness. So I don't think of this world as my world, our world. May all of us pivot our attention away from this world. That's what I want for everyone. So that's what I receive for myself. I want to pivot my attention off this world. Now, because of our honor and creativity, we may still see this world. There may be some beautiful spot that we'll still say, well, okay, I'll still pay a little attention to this. Yeah, that's okay. Yeah, it's not like we're trying to triumph over anything, okay? Pragmatically. But we may just see it as just this little bubble of beauty, so to speak, and not really view it as a world. I never view this world as a world. I don't. I don't think I'm some, you know, globe floating in space. I never think of it that way. I never see it that way. And I never look up at the sky and wonder, like at night with all the stars. I say, oh, you know, how beautiful the heavens are. And I never feel any attraction to the space and the stars and the universe. I never feel any attraction to it at all. It's all just a mental projection, our desire to believe in abnormality is all it is. Physical boundaries. Boundaries means structure, means limitations, boundaries on freedom. Jesus tells, this is all our own making, this universe of the planets and the stars. It's not from God. It's not from God. And he said to Tom, he said, that one went right past you, didn't it? You didn't catch it. I caught it. I saw that. Boom! He said, right there. Thank you, Jesus. but Jesus said, that goes right past everyone. It didn't go past me. That is for sure. Because I've never been really interested in the notion of this universe. So what is the universe? It's a junk pile. It's a dream of vulnerability. You know, we don't deserve that. No one deserves that. I don't want anyone to have a dream of vulnerability. That's hard. Would you give your the allness a dream of vulnerability? And I'm speaking of all everyone as the allness. There's only the allness. We would give the allness a dream of being vulnerable, and so that can lose the allness. What? No. Why would we do that? Except just on a capricious, absurdist whim, trying to see if we can undo what God has created. And it's like we're greater than God. Otherwise, it would, you know, there'd be no motivation to do it whatsoever. Destroy all in this way. Destroy why? Right? So, you know, the worst thing you can do is desire a universe, this universe for the allness. You know, our universe is so beautiful, our world is so beautiful. No, it's we can't help, our creativity cannot help but express beautifully. But it doesn't mean, just because it has some beauty, it doesn't mean that we should desire for everyone. Because it's really the vulnerability of beauty is what we're really expressing here. So why would you want beauty to be vulnerable? And want the allness to have that? That's vulnerable. So just because you're saying it's beauty, that's only half the equation. It's vulnerable. It's a dream of beauty, the vulnerability of beauty and freedom and all that. So why would you say, oh, here's your world. You're so fortunate that this universe and this world, this is your home. It's not my home. I don't desire it to be a home for anyone. And so it's not my home. Give and you shall receive. Give and you shall receive. Give and ye shall receive. But you think, oh, well, if I don't try to fix it up, it won't be beautiful. You know, you see all this stuff, the magazines, all these pictures of you know, how people have landscaped their yard in the parks and this and this. And I look at that and I just shrug my shoulders and say, oh. You know, it's still vulnerable beauty is all it is. That's all I see. All I see, I can see it immediately. I say, well, that you're just trying to interest me in the vulnerability of beauty. You're presenting beauty, but in the context of vulnerability. I'm not interested in that. I'm not interested in giving that to anyone. And therefore, I'm not interested in giving it to myself either. Pretty simple, isn't it? See, when you talk about it this way, it all is very simple. But very few talk about it like this. And even fewer get it. You know, they say, hey, yeah, you catch it. As Jesus said at times, you didn't catch that. Went right past you. But he did bring that to his attention. Like, you know, this is very important, but that goes right past most of us here, right? We keep focused on how can we make this universe our home. You know, it's like how can we make a dream of the vulnerability of beauty our home? Why would we want to make it our home when we have the invulnerability of beauty as our home already? It's not that we have to fix this universe somehow. We already have our home. We're just pretending that we don't have it. So to stop dreaming means to stop pretending that we don't have a home of invulnerable beauty. But we do. And this is what the gurus come to tell us, the Dharma kings. They come to tell us just as we already have a home of invulnerable beauty, which is endlessly creatively beautiful in our experiencing. We already have that. We're just pretending that we don't have it. So just stop pretending that we don't have it, and we'll realize that we have it. It's literally that simple. But our expectations don't expect it to be that simple. So our expectations pull us into absurdist complexity. And so what our practicing here is to pivot out of that absurdist complexity onto just the stark simplicity of it. But it's difficult for everyone, isn't it? It has not been easy for me at all. And remains a challenge, right? I keep working on it. Because of our expectations. The interlocking defensiveness of our expectations continually pivots us back into absurdity because we expect, so if we don't do that, you say, well, I won't know what to expect. I won't know what to do. I won't know what to do. I won't know what to fix. We don't need to fix anything. We don't need to fix anything. I can't fix anything. Say that. I can't fix anything. So work on your expectations that I can't fix anything at all. That's your expectations. Pragmatically is a different story, of course. If there's something you need to fix here, you know, handyman, take out a light bulb and then put a new light bulb, you do it. You just do it. But you don't see yourself as fixing anything at the level of fixing the world, so to speak. So your expectations. So work on your expectations. That is key. There's no one who has pivoted to paradise who has not had to get past their expectations. Not one of us. You say, well, Sri Sri Anandamaya Ma, but she never left paradise. So she never, ever pretended that beauty was vulnerable. Therefore, she said she had no karma at all. She came in the world not from any pull of karma whatsoever. Now, this is very rare. Okay, we're not in that same boat. We certainly came into this world from the pull of our expectations. Karma really is really just our expectations. That's all it is. So we do have to work on our expectations. So none of us here, unless you are a perfect avatar, which in case you will understand that what I'm saying here doesn't apply to you, so I don't need to hedge what I'm saying at all. So none of us here can get to pivot to paradise without working on our expectations. And keep in mind, the avatar doesn't need to pivot at all. They never left. So all who need to pivot to paradise, which if you're not already experiencing perfect invulnerability of beauty, then you most definitely need to pivot to paradise. So all of us who need to pivot to paradise, which is all of us, we can only do that through working on our expectations. Now, you can do it all at once. Leave your expectations all at once, which Jesus says is extremely, extremely rare. Not even worth talking about. It's so rare. Or you can do it gradually. Work on your expectations bit by bit. But you can go fast or you can go slow on working on your expectations. The suddenness is just simply you realize there's nothing I need to do. You accept that. Once you accept there's nothing I need to do to fix reality, It's not vulnerable. It was never vulnerable. So there's nothing I need to do. You drop all notion of I doing anything. And that, then, reality is apparent to you. It's a sudden enlightenment. But you didn't get to sudden enlightenment without first reshaping your expectations that you would get to sudden enlightenment. Practicing that you're already there. Like Dzogchen has practiced that they're already there. That's the practice. This is indeed the most powerful practice, is to simply tell yourself, reinforce over and over and over and over and over that you're already there. You don't need to do anything at all. You're already there. Now that's indeed the highest practice. And we practice in that way a lot. Right? Now, if you were to just do nothing but that, I'm already there, and just be immersed in this already there-ness, you would awaken from the pivot out of the dream. Your attention would pivot off the dream quite quickly. It wouldn't take long. And if you were to do it just perfectly right this moment, you would pivot this moment off of the dream. If you were absolutely convinced that you're already there, you would pivot off the stream right away. And theoretically, we have the will to do that. We do. But there aren't really any instances, or perhaps extremely rare instances, of anyone just, well, the one instant, actually there is an instance of, that's Ramaharshi. He instantly pivoted off his attention off the dream. Out of the blue, he just instantly pivoted his attention off the dream. And realized, I don't need to do anything. I don't need to do anything at all. So he did do that. But that's super, super rare. And he tells us, nobody gets there without tremendous effort. He's an exception. But apparently, there's been a lot of speculation on this, and apparently he had put in massive effort in previous lives. And he returned to this world to help us, knowing indeed he could pivot off of this dream instantly, which he did. But he put in apparently tremendous effort in previous lives, and was able to pivot off of it in a previous life. So when he came back into this world, when he was mature enough to leave home, he waited until he's mature enough to leave home, like 15, I believe. And when he was mature enough to leave home, then he just decided, you know, it's time for me to fulfill my purpose here. And he just instantly pivoted off the dream and never went back to it. And he was completely established in the non-dual, the invulnerable, reality's invulnerable recognition. Right away, he said, right away, and it never left him. See, so he came back on a mission to do that. So if you were enlightened in a previous life and you've come back specifically to help out now, it is possible for you to pivot off instantly. But for the rest of us, that's pragmatically not feasible. So we really, really have to work at it. As Ramaharshi said, you must be steady determination, very diligent. You must continually bring yourself back to the stark simplicity of it. They were already there. There's nothing I need to do. There's nothing I need to fix. I just need to stop pretending there's something to fix. And that's the end of the dream. We have to bring ourselves back to this again and again and again and again and again. And it is very difficult for most of us. It's really the most difficulty we'll ever experience in a concentrated way to keep trying to pull our attention back to this, right? Because you get it for a moment, and then suddenly you've completely been swept away, you know, into how do I fix the world? I got it, but how do I fix the world? And you say, wait a minute, but didn't I just see I don't need, there's nothing to fix? This is all just pretense and nothing more than that. I mean, if we just pretend, you know, we're crippled, and then we'd say, well, pretend that I'm not so crippled. I walk with a limp instead of real crippled. But we're still in a dream of pretending. You know, at any moment we can suddenly pretend we're really crippled again because we haven't given up the purpose of the dream. So that's not stability at all, is it? That's not invulnerable beauty. That's vulnerable beauty, and we can just shuffle the deck and play with that endlessly if we want. But it's all the same dream. It's still vulnerable beauty. Vulnerability. That's not giving up the dream at all. So as we're mountain biking through off-road, we might say, I'm not so crippled. You know, I'm going off-road. I'm not so crippled. Beauty's not so crippled. But we haven't given up the purpose of crippled beauty, have we? No, haven't. We've just modified it. So we can play the mod game endlessly of modifying. That's not the spiritual path. That's not bringing our mind to recognizing I don't need to do anything except stop all pretending. That's all. Stop pretending to be crippled. Stop pretending to modify being crippled. Just give up pretending altogether. That's all we need to do. That's called the dream. I call it pretending. Imagining for the mind to imagine is really pretending. Imagining is crippled. Is pretending. The mind's pretending it's crippled. The mind is crippled. But it's vulnerable. It's not really crippled, it's not really sick, it's not really vulnerable at all. And that's true right now. Again, when you're pretending, you are not really crippled. If you're pretending to be crippled, you're not really crippled right now. You don't have to wait a moment, say, wait a minute, I have to wait to heal this crippledness. You just decide to stop pretending, and the crippledness vanishes without a trace, because it never had any independent causation at all. There's no independent causation of what we call conditioned existence, of this universe. It's all directly in the moment, a pretense of the mind. It never can stray from that at all. So we don't need to do anything at all, except stop pretending that there's something to fix, that we need to fix something. Just give up pretense. I'm trying to stay off the roads today, the traffic, beach traffic. I think Saturday was probably worse than Sunday, but I'm not going to bother to try to find out. It may be massive hordes going over there, descending on the beach, trying to modify. I can't modify anything. Here's a great affirmation. I can't modify anything at all. I'm incapable of any modification. I am incapable of any modification. I'm incapable of any modification. There isn't even a single modification that I can ever make. I'll never be able to make even a single modification. So this is very helpful to practice humility. But hearing this academically as if you're accumulating knowledge is no help, really no help to you. Pragmatically, it's of no help to you whatsoever. Only by asserting it as if it were true is it actually helpful to reshape your expectations. Expectations must be reshaped by you asserting something as if it were true for you right now. Not in the future, not in the past, but right now. So right this instant, I am totally incapable of any modification whatsoever. I'll never be able to make even the slightest modification in anything whatsoever. I'll never be able to make even the slightest modification in anything whatsoever. Now I can feel that one. See, that hit home. strong. So that affected my expectations very strongly, which that's what you're after in your practice. You want to keep on practicing, looking to feel, you know, the feeling like, wow, that really hit a nerve. And this one did. The burn is arising now, this burn of shock. You feel it like in your core, maybe in your core nervous system, it just seems to show up. It's like it just reverberating and resonating, and like a bell, this big bell has been hit, and it's just vibrating like, oh my gosh, my expectations have really got, you know, got hit, got gonged there. Wow. Never, ever be able to make even the slightest modification to anything whatsoever, to any context whatsoever. I'm completely incapable of even the slightest modification in any context whatsoever, past, now, future, any context. I'm totally incapable of making the slightest modification. Our true creativity in reality is not a modification of anything. It's a fresh expression. It's always fresh expression, not a modification of anything. What came before, what we experienced before, is untouched by what we're experiencing in this moment. So there's no modifications take place in reality whatsoever. So I am totally incapable of making any modification of any type whatsoever. Of anything, of any context at all. I'm totally incapable. I have absolute incapacity for any modification. I cannot modify at all. I'll never be able to modify at all. I've never been able to modify anything. Say that I've never been able to modify anything, and I never will be able to modify anything. So saying this absolutely has having a profound effect. I'm experiencing it right now. This is not something you ever expect yourself to say, to affirm, to believe, to accept. Therefore, this goes counter to your expectations in a very profound way. So this shakes you up profoundly, and you start to go into shock. And we say, wow, this is exactly what I expect for the day that I'm going to experience. Wow. So that's in line with my expectations. Wow. I'm having a wow day. Having a wow day, 360 degree in every way, right? It's a wow day. It's just a wow day. If you want to, you can have a little prop. Just hold on to this little prop and just say, wow. I feel wow. But I tend to do it without a prop. It's probably better. Because then we start wanting to hold on to bodies, you know. It's better to just feel as if you're just floating in spaciousness. Wow. You're nowhere at all, actually. You don't know where you are, and that's okay. I'm feeling wow. I'm feeling this feeling of wow. That's what I expect. So you start out your day expecting to feel the wow. And then this enables you to practice in such a way that it goes super counter to our expectations. I can't modify anything. I've never been able to modify anything. I'll never will be able to modify anything whatsoever. Wow. Really runs counter to our expectations in the deepest way. You're going to feel the wow. But I'm saying, like, great. I expect to feel the wow. That's what I'm feeling, so my expectations are being met. So no panic, you see. This blocks the panic. Even with this going profoundly counter to the deepest expectations that somehow we can modify something eventually, I still no panic, because I'm experiencing what I expect, which is the wow. So my expectations in terms of what I'm going to experience are being met. That blocks panic. It absolutely blocks panic. It's that simple. It's really that simple. So the path is very simple. We make these assertions that run counter to our expectations, as if that's already the case. This produces this shock. But we go into our practice expecting to experience the wow. And so when the shock arises, we say, well, that's exactly what I expected. I'm really in this wow condition of elation and trepidation. And so therefore it blocks panic, and we don't panic, and our path remains smooth, and we don't lose momentum. There isn't a big backlash. We don't suddenly plunge back into trying to modify something to get back to we don't try to reconstitute our expectations that we can modify anything by ferociously trying to modify something. We might be tempted in that a bit. We probably will as you go throughout your day. You say, I need to modify something. Let me work on some graphics, or just say, wow. Just let it sit here until it wears off. Give yourselves a chance to breathe and get used to being without the expectation that you can modify anything, ever. Get used to that expectation. And that becomes your new expectations, new expectation. You don't expect to be able to modify anything at all. See, that's your expectation. And that opens, you're then open to experiencing the bird of paradise, where everything is fresh and in the moment. And that doesn't have the sense of any modification of anything taking place at all. It's just flowing, free-flowing, exquisite beauty, invulnerable to any modification. So you're allowing that now, because that's what you expect. You say, that doesn't run counter to my expectations at all. Once you've reworked your expectations, and so it doesn't shock you, and so you allow it to stay with you. Say, I'm not shocked by this at all. This is normal for me. This is normal. But shock? Why am I shocked? It's normal. It's meeting my expectations beautifully. So there's no shock arises. Shock arises when our expectations aren't met. And that leads to panic, to try to modify. But to get things back the way we expect them to be. So when people complain, we complain, like, I saw the bird of paradise, but it left. You know, that's because our expectations, we went into shock, and we say, I want things to go back the way I expect them to be. And that bird of paradise was so unexpected, I didn't expect that, so I don't want it. I don't want it right now. Maybe I'll expect it later. So that's why it leaves, seems to leave. Our attention pivots off of it. So when we say it appears out of nowhere, it's really our attention actually pivots to it. And we don't realize that it's always there. It's just our attention wasn't on that at all. We didn't expect to see it. But when we expect to see it and we pivot our attention to it, suddenly it's there. We say, it appeared out of nowhere. So it's extremely simple. I tried to bring this extreme simplicity into the world, but of course, nobody expected it. So they their attention just pivoted off of it just severely, continuously and severely. So that caused me, my attention, to pivot off of it too. Eventually, you know, they got induced to that thinking, I can't reach anybody, you know. It's they don't seem reachable. So but every guru says that, you know, that very few actually come to accept the simplicity and practice this way. They all come to say, how can you help me modify the dream? You know, instead of to stop dreaming, they want to modify it. So one of the most profound practices we can do to prepare us for the bird of paradise is to say, I have no capacity, I'll never have any capacity to modify anything in any way. I will never have any capacity to modify anything in any way. I simply don't have it, and I'll never have it. I have no capacity to modify anything in any way, and I'll never have any capacity to modify anything in any way. And I'm okay with that. Yeah. I'm okay with that. Practice this way, feeling this, that you're okay with that. Now, many feel this is like too risky. How will I function? How will I do this? You can still function without seeing it as a modification, actually. If you want to put a new light bulb in, you put a new light bulb in. But you're not modifying anything. You don't see it as modification at all. You see, each moment is fresh and new. In no way is it experiencing any modification of anything. You can literally experience in that way here. This is the word of Jesus and all the Dharma kings. If you expect that, but you must expect it. And so everyone says, well, how do I do that? By working on your expectations as we are doing. Directly work on your expectations directly. That is the fast path. The other path is very, very slow. Too slow, you might say. You stall out. You work a little bit at in very indirectly. But meanwhile, most of your attention is trying to modify the world. So you're reinforcing your belief that modifying the dream is necessary. And by reinforcing that continuously, you're making up an orphan out of your spiritual path. Even though you may pay a little attention to a little bit of spirituality, it's still really an orphan. It feels like an orphan to you, actually. You haven't really adopted it. What I did was when I was 18, I adopted... I'm sorry, not 18, 20. When I was 20 years old, I adopted this orphan, which was really the truth, which is really reality. And a dream has presented me as this abandoned little baby, a Christ child. I adopted the Christ child, you might say. It was abandoned. There was nobody would claim it. And I just said, wow, I cannot subject this infant to the vulnerabilities of this world without any parent. Nobody will claim it at all. It's going to, the wolves are going to eat it. I mean, this is horrible. And so I, in this dream, I said, wow. I kept asking, you know whose child this is? Nobody said, no, I don't know. I said, I waited until it was getting dark. And is anybody going to claim this child? Nobody, they just passed it by like, we're not going to have anything to do with this child. And finally I said, well, I got no choice. I got to do the right thing. I've got to take this child with me. I took this child with me into the city. And then I went about for years trying to find the parents of this child, and nobody would claim it. And they said, leave us alone. It's not ours. It's not ours. Nobody would claim it. And then finally I came to the child and I said, I got to tell you something, that I'm going to have to try and raise you myself. But I don't have a clue how to raise a child. I'm sure that I'll cause you to be mentally ill, you know. I'll traumatize you by my incompetence, you know, to raise a child. Nobody will help me. Nobody will help me at all, I said. And I don't know, I don't have any child-rearing instincts, you know. And so I apologized to the child. And I just said, you know, what can I do? I'll do my very best. I really will do my very, very best. But I know it won't go well for you. But it's better than abandoning you, you know. And then when I told the child this, the child suddenly morphed into this golden avatar of living light. It turned into this living light itself. And I realized this, the living light was just pretending to be this child. And then I really picked up reality itself, the light of reality itself. And that was the child that I was taking care of. And it actually was raising me. I was the orphan to it, you see. And that it was going to actually parent me into that which it is. I didn't know that originally at all. And then it showed me what it really was. And then I realized there's nothing I can do to damage its mental health. It's impossible. But I was still kind of nervous, like, oh, how can I help this out? But deep down I said, wow, I'm okay with it. Okay, because I can't damage it at all. So I'll keep this with me. But really, it's the one that's raising me up. So that was when I was 20 years old. That was 40 years ago. So it's really been raising me for 40 years. And doing a good job of it. Have fun. Happy Father's Day. Have fun. Have fun. I'm having more than fun. I'm doing what I really love. Absolutely, I'm doing what I really love. I can't even. I'm an idiot when it comes to texting. What? Okay. Yeah, a nice little break there. Very intense because I was distraught, you know, thinking I'm going to ruin this child, not being able to give it the right experiences. I told the child, look, I'm focused on spiritual enlightenment. You know, I can't give you a normal upbringing at all. I'm totally focused on the spiritual path here. I'm totally engrossed, focused, and focused on this, and all my attention is there. And so I won't, you know, I'll ignore you, I'll neglect you, I won't give you all the experiences, I don't care about schooling, and you're going to end up retarded, you're going to end up so disadvantaged, you know. And I said, but I can't help it, this is who I am. And then the child then revealed it, that it was the divine child, saying, don't you worry, I don't need any of that stuff. I'm already perfect. I'm perfect and I can't be other than perfect, so you won't cause me any trouble at all, don't worry about that at all. I'm here to help you, actually. But, you know, subtly, under the radar. But now we look at this and just, wow, okay, that's wow. We don't get lost in the emotion of it. Never get lost in the emotion of your spiritual practice. Never get lost in the emotion of your spiritual practice. When you feel the shock of it, it's really profound, you go straight to the wow. So this is what I expected, so I'm going to stay with what I expect, which is this wow. When if you let all these turbulent emotions arise, that's not what you expect, actually. You say, whoa, wait a minute, I'm trying to have spiritual peace here, you know, and then you get lost. But you say, no, I expected to be shocked by the profundity of this. So I'm okay with the shock of that. That's the wow, and I'll just stay with that. A friend of mine wished me Happy Father's Day yesterday. He said, do you have any children? I said, well, I have stepchildren. And he shook me and then he said, oh, you can give a bro hug. You know, bro hug. And I said, "You have children?" He said, "Yeah." I said, "But I'm going through a divorce right now, so I probably won't see them. I'll have to go over to my friend's house. I'll just hang out with my friend." And then a little later, we talked about what's what's going on. I said, "Well, trust. The trust was betrayed. Trust was betrayed. She married, and the spouse went out, saw with another man. Went out with another man, and now saying like, well, maybe we can get back together again, and this kind of thing." But he said, "I'm suspicious now. I don't trust. I'm suspicious." And like Elvis Presley said, we can't go on with suspicious minds. And I said, the heart of any relationship is trust. If you don't trust, you don't really have a relationship. You're always, in the back of your mind, you're always suspicious and thinking, and it's hell. And he said, "Yeah, it's hell. It's absolute hell. I can't go on. I couldn't go on this way. It's hell." So, trust in the Holy Spirit. Have a relationship with the Holy Spirit, with the bird of paradise. Trust that it will show up. It'll be there. When you pivot your attention to it, it will be there. So I put my faith and trust in that relationship. And I don't have a suspicious mind about the Holy Spirit. I don't have the belief it'll go out with someone else, leave me. The Holy Spirit is there for all of us. Since I give the Holy Spirit to everyone, my desire is that everyone have the Holy Spirit. Therefore, it's there for me, you see? It's there for me. It's capable of appearing to everyone, simply because reality is already present for everyone. And we only need to pivot our attention. And the Holy Spirit is this bridge to reality that it still appears to have some form or structure, even though its wings moving in such a way that it seems very ethereal and floating and very unflesh-like, very unflesh-like. But it still seems to be some structure there. So we still are honoring our creativity. So it acts like as a bridge. The Holy Spirit's like a bridge to reality where there's really no structure, no limitation, no boundaries at all to our creative freedom. So that will be there. When you pivot your attention to it, that will be there for you. Holy Spirit has always been there for me. Whenever I turn to it, it's never been absent, actually. It's never been absent. It's never going out with someone else, so to speak, like abandoning me. Never. It's already present for everyone. So where can it go? It's going out with everyone. So how can it pivot? How can it, be going out with someone else other than everyone? There's no someone else other than everyone, everywhere. Okay, so it can't go out with someone else. It's not possible for the Holy Spirit. So we don't have the suspicious mind, right? So always have faith in the Holy Spirit. It can't leave us. It can't leave us. So we keep trying to pivot our attention to the Holy Spirit, this bird of paradise. Now in this dream, it perched, and then I pivoted away from the perching, so it flew up in the sky, but I didn't pivot away from it. It was still present for me. And I said, "Okay, you can come back." And I said, "Okay, so when I want it to perch, it will, and when I want it to just hover right there for me, it will. So it'll both perch and then hover for me." But it didn't disappear. My attention remained on it. So to me, that symbolizes that it has two levels of intensity. When it's perched, my attention was fully on it, and it was in the sky hovering. My attention was able to be aware of the world, also the house, the porch area, peripherally. So that's very functional bliss. And then when it perched on me, it was more like being immersed in the bliss. And you saw that with Sri Sri Nandamayama, how she had this functional bliss, and then at other times she would go into this, her eyes would close, and she would just be absorbed in the bliss, completely absorbed in it. And people say that she was just radiant, you know, and just, and people just, it was so profound. But after a while, they'd say, can you interact with us a little bit? You know, it was so intense for us. We want a little bit of functional bliss from you now too. And she would do that. So she could shift gears that way, shifted gears. That's what we want to be able to do, is shift gears. We want to have the functional bliss, and at times just be absorbed in the bliss. Ramaharshi the same way, right? He would be functional in a lot of ways with those who came to Ramanashram, and other times he would just be absorbed in the bliss. Now, Sri Sri Ananda Maima said she never slept. And they said, well, we see you close your eyes. She said, yeah, I'm closing my eyes because that's what you expect. She says, I don't want to run counter to your expectations too much here. That'll cause a problem for you. See, expectations. She was absolutely, acutely aware of expectations and the play of expectations. She said, that's the whole thing here. So she said, I'll lie down if you want me to. And I'll close my eyes if you want me to. So you think I'm sleeping. I'm doing what you expect. But she says, in no way am I the slightest bit asleep. And in no way, she just remained absorbed in this bliss. She says, I see no difference. There's no difference between when I lie down and close my eyes and when my eyes are open and I'm walking and functioning with you. No difference at all to me. None whatsoever. Exactly the same. Now, many look at Sri Sri Ananda Maima and you say, Ma, you know, you're so wonderful, what a wonderful mother. You're my mother, what a wonderful mother. Well, that's good, but there's another intensity to it all, which is, holy cow, this avatar is capable of going against all my expectations at a drop of the hat. And it's really a play, she's really doing a play of expectations with me. And profoundly shocking me, shocking my expectations. So that's how I took it. So I engaged in this play of a lila of sadhana, of a play of spiritual practice, of having my expectations shocked. I kept realizing, hey, wait a minute, she just completely defied my expectations there, totally defied them. And then this way, and this way, and this way, and this way, and this way. So I've been going through, it's been 20 years, actually, of that for me. 20 years. Very stressful. And she said, look, she said about die, she said, I don't need to, says, but you expect me to, so I will. Because I said, if I didn't die, that would shock your expectations so badly that it would cause too much backlash for you, and you'd stall out. So I'll let this body seem to age and fade away and die. But she says, really, I don't have to at all. I don't even have to age a bit. Don't even have to grow up. Don't have to do anything, actually, here. She says, there's nothing of your expectations in this world that I need to meet at all for my sake. Not one. Not even one. Again, not even one expectation that we hold in this world does she need to meet, feel that she needs to meet at all. Not one. She's capable of not meeting any of them without any slightest disturbance whatsoever. But for this, our sake, she pretended to meet some of these expectations. Jai Guru, you know. Praise to the Guru, you know. I call upon the Guru. Jai Guru. Some say Jai, some say Jai. You know, I say Jai. It seems to rhyme better. Jai Guru, I like that better. It's the same, Jai. Jai Guru, you know, just, that's all praise, you know, that play of expectations, that's the Guru. That's the Guru. That's the awesome Guru. The avatar, the avatara, Jai Guru, that you know they're just showing up here to help you get past your expectations. They're not doing it here because of their expectations, any need that they have at all. I mean, she dropped dead because those around her expected. She said, we want you to be dead. We thought you were coming here to fulfill a role. You're not doing it, so you might as well be dead to us. And when she felt that from them, she literally dropped dead. Her body dropped dead, and it turned into a corpse and began rotting and stenching with stench, hideous, all the rot, like a body left in the street to rot after it's dead. You know, fungus and mildew and mold and rotting pus and everything right in front of their eyes, right on the ground in front of them. And of course, it absolutely freaked them out. And it shocked them so badly, they said, okay, we'll do it your way. And as soon as they changed their attitude, her body revived without a trace of age. It revived in a sublimely beautiful way, like shining with light, radiant and bliss, just like that. Kind of shocking to be around someone like that, huh? Yeah. All kudos to the Dharmic culture of India that they could even allow her to show up. They're willing to have her show up. Massive kudos to the great spiritual culture of Bengal, you know, stretching back thousands of years, that they were willing to call upon someone who was capable, who had no did not need to fulfill any expectations whatsoever, and they're willing to engage with that. You know, that's you know, praise to that culture. That's a Dharmic culture right there. See, but a Dharmic culture enables that. A Dharmic culture enables even an avatar to show up. In physical form, like an avatar, to pretend to have a body. It enables that. So keep in mind when you wonder, what's the purpose of Dharmic culture? It enables that. It enables that. And just one glimpse of an avatar like that is enough to trigger remembrance of what you are, really are, that you are that as well. Just one glimpse. Even a picture, or in a picture in a video, it triggers it. And then this is supremely helpful for your spiritual awakening, you know, to drop pretending that you're anything other than that, actually. So it's super, Dharmic culture is super important. Vastly beneficial to all of us. So that area of Bengal has been blessed by tremendous a number of gurus, really. But to have an avatar there, wow. That's saying, you know, what more needs to be said, actually. That they've really got after their spiritual practice in with very steady determination throughout the ages. And obviously, and I can't speak to the present time because the world has fallen so badly, you know, that, and I, you know, online, I tried to get a feel for that Facebook, many Bengali devotees, and, you know, it's not what it used to be. It's not what it used to be. That's for sure. Because they should be saying, we're absolutely sure that she can return, that she can reappear, or the avatar can reappear. Keep in mind, that's an avatar. Avatar can appear like that. They have no need to either appear nor disappear. It all depends on what you're willing to engage in. If you're willing to engage in lila of expectations, the lila of sadhana of expectations, then the avatar can appear, absolutely. So we don't need to cling, you know, to the past. We should be focused right now, saying, right now I can pivot my attention to the bird of paradise. Right now I can pivot my attention to the bird of paradise. but they seem to be somewhat forlorn, you know, about it. It's like she's gone. Gone? Where can she go? Where can an avatar go? What need do they have to disappear somewhere? Where can they disappear to? Where can the allness disappear to? They didn't have any desire to appear in the first place. We're the ones that, they're the ones that called them, you know, into this world. So, be committed be determined to entertain that, and it will again present itself. Just pivot your attention to it. Now, that was done in 1896. A lot of gurus came in 1896, 1897. A lot of, it's amazing how many. I keep coming across gurus that were born then. It seemed to be a most auspicious year, 1896, 97, that time. Amazing. I think Krishnamurti was born in 1897, actually. That was a time when people really, really were very serious, took it very seriously, very dharmic. And they needed to be because of the 20th century. There was a realization that if we don't really focus and bear down on it now, we're going to lose it. And to a large extent, that's what's happened. It's kind of now like fading into the past, isn't it? Like sort of a mythic era. And at some point, the world will see it like, well, it never really happened. It was just kind of falsely reported. That's what they'll say. That's what they'll say. They're already saying that. That whatever happened in the past as far as a truly dharmic culture, all that stuff, the foundations of it all, everything that happened, it didn't really happen the way that it was said at all. It was falsely reported by people kind of just made it up. You know, just made up. That's what the tech people say. You know, those who are into roboticism and all of that modernism, they believe that none of that really happened at all. It was just falsely reported, just our imagination. It didn't really take place at all. So there's nothing there. They say there's nothing to see there, actually. Nothing to see. So they're willing to, for Dharmic culture to sink to the bottom of the ocean, actually. And for them, it already has. For them, it's already has sunk to the bottom of the ocean, like the Titanic sinking. But we are in the lifeboats. We're in lifeboats here. It's lifeboat time right now. Because truly, the iceberg of indifference in this world has hit the Titanic. And we thought it was unsinkable. Dharma was unsinkable. Dharma culture. No. They definitely have sunk it to the bottom of the ocean. But we're wise enough to get into lifeboats. And who's to say that we can't have a captain in our lifeboat? And who's to say that some gorgeous, exquisitely beautiful ocean liner, cruise ship won't come by and pick us up out of those lifeboats? If we accept it, it will. If we pivot our attention to it, it's already there, actually. We're in this lifeboats in this icy ocean, and the Titanic's at the bottom of the ocean right now. Dharmic culture is the bottom of the ocean right now, actually. And we're the survivors of that sinking. And so we still have Dharmic culture within us. But the cultural ship has sunk. So we need to pivot our attention to realize there's this gorgeous cruise ship there. There's this exquisitely beautiful cruise ship there to pick us up. It's right there. But if we don't expect it, we won't see it. And if we're just in misery, like, oh my God, we're in this lifeboat in the middle of this dark, and there's ice, bunch of ice in the ocean, and it's a frigid, freezing ocean, and it's choppy, and we're so disoriented, we're so shocked, my gosh, we lost the ship of Dharmic culture has sunk. And if we just focus on that, we won't pivot our attention to this bird of paradise cruise ship that's right there, with the stairway already down in the water. So all we have to do is row our boat a little bit over to it. It's right there. And we just step out of the rowboat. It's attached there to the stairway. And we just step out and we walk up the stairway. And we're on this absolutely indescribably beautiful cruise ship that can't be sunk at all. The unsinkable cruise ship, actually. Unsinkable. To cruise the seven seas, you know, have this go on this just absolutely undescribably wonderful cruise. All we have to do is pivot our attention to to the fact it's already there. Don't spend our time praying, God, please help me, we're in such a terrible situation. Say, no, I know, God, you already anticipated all this. There's no question about it. I know you sent this cruise ship there. I know it's already there. All I have to do is pivot my attention, my expectations, pivot it, and then I will see, out of nowhere, it seemed to like appear out of nowhere. Like, where did it come from? Well, it was already there. We just didn't expect to see it. That's how powerful expectations are. It shapes our perception. They said that the Indians in South America, when the Spanish ships were on the horizon coming in the shore, they never saw them because they never expected any such thing. In their perceptual expectations, nothing like that could possibly exist. So they literally didn't see it. And suddenly all these Spanish had come ashore, and they did expect to see people, human form. So they said, where'd you come from? They thought they came from heaven because they don't know. Just suddenly, out of nowhere, they were there. So they thought that God must have sent them. They couldn't see the ships. They couldn't see the ships. That's how powerful our expectations are. Our perception is based on expectation, actually. Perception is based on expectation. So we have to allow ourselves to expect that this indescribably beautiful Bird of Paradise cruise ship is right there. And we can easily be picked up by it, walk up on its deck. We have to expect it's there. It is there, it is there, it is there. I absolutely know it is there, no doubt about it. And as then, we'll pivot our attention, our perception, there, and lo and behold, it is there. It is there. But we'll kind of be shocked. Where did you come from? I didn't even see you arrive. It didn't arrive, it was already there. It didn't arrive, it was already there. It didn't arrive, it was already there. So our willingness to expect it to be there throughout the ages here, the last, for me, I've always been willing that it be there. That's all it takes to be there. Since we're willing to go in that direction, we're willing to not sink to the bottom of the ocean. It's there. So, Dharmic culture may have sunk to the bottom of the ocean, but there's a new Dharmic culture present that's even better than the old one. It's even better. It's even better. It's simpler. It's much clearer. It's much simpler. It's much more streamlined. And you'll say, this I can really get with this. No doubt, but I can see, I can really recognize it. It's so simple. So we can thank the techies for sinking the Titanic, because we have something even better. That's really unsinkable. Because it lives in us, you know, it lives in us. It's so simple. It's unsinkably simple. It's unsinkably simple, and so we've gotten to that. So the old form of Dharmic culture has served its purpose. So now that we're willing to accept an unsinkable Dharmic culture, it's completely unsinkable. Truly, what we're talking about here openly, it would only have been looked at from the very most advanced practice in the past. Ah, I said, don't call me. What is this? Ah, and they call anyway. Beautiful. Hello? I'm in the middle of something. Can you get Diana or JC to do something? Thank you. So, it was indeed an effort to interrupt. Get out of the lifeboat. And I said, look, get someone else to do it. Wow. Even though you instruct people, don't interrupt, they still interrupt. Right? They go counter to your advice. Non-dharmic, you see. Those who are non-dharmic think they know a better way. They think that having dharmic culture at the bottom of the ocean is the way. So they can forget about it. They think that forgetting about reality is the answer. And they think they can completely forget about it. Cannot. Because pretending never becomes independently caused. So you always know that you're pretending. It's always there in the back of your mind. You can never get rid of that. You can never get rid of it. Because as soon as you start pretending, the pretense stops. You say, whoa, what happened? You know, what caused that? I don't understand. So always there's that insecurity there. Never can you be free of that insecurity of trying to forget reality. There's always a feeling of insecurity. And since you're trying to be ignorant, fear of the abyss. Great fear and insecurity. Always. You can't forget that. That's with you. And that's really indication that it's just pretense. And vulnerability has nothing to do with reality. So you have to reshape your expectations. The fear of the abyss is just your expectations barking. Just your expectations barking. Yeah. Now see, I would have come out of the wow of what we're doing, the profundity of it, into the mundane, non-dharmic culture context. And that would cause quite a shock. Quite a shock. People come go out of church, they want to go to some fast food restaurant. I say, well, if you come out of church, aren't you supposed to be in shock of having gone beyond your expectations? In terms of accepting the presence of God that is already present. And why do you want to go to some fast food restaurant, a very, very non-dharmic place, to immerse yourself in that? That's going to cause, you know, very, very stormy seas for you. Not a good idea at all. That they don't even consider that. Because they don't get that from church. Because church isn't really offering it. In fact, church kind of promises you that they won't do that. They say, don't worry, we've done it for you. Let the priest take care of that. You just show up and you're safe from that. You don't have to do that. It's like, you don't have to reshape your expectations. We'll do that for you. I mean, that's like saying, we'll breathe for you. You don't have to breathe. We'll breathe for you. You don't have to eat. We'll eat for you. Of course, that's what everybody most want to hear. Oh, yeah, that's scary. I don't want to do that work. You know, I want everything to be the way I expect. Yeah, I don't want anything to be what I don't expect it. You know, it's scary. So, yeah, you do that for us. So the priestess promises, yeah, we'll experience the Holy Spirit for you. We'll do all stuff for you. You don't have to do that. Don't worry. Just show up every week, every day. And then if you do that, you'll get to heaven. And it's, they're able to institutionalize for an empire that way. It's a great, great control system for an empire. And a bureaucracy. It's a great bureaucratic control system. Yeah, you don't want to be like, that's such a mystery, right? Don't worry, you know, we'll help you avoid that mystery. Going beyond your expectations is always a mystery. You don't know what to expect. You have to take the way of the cross and continuously go beyond your expectations. And now with this new Dharmic culture we have here, we just simply do that directly. In no way can I ever modify anything. See, that's the new way. That's the new Dharmic culture. The old Dharmic culture, indeed, it is sinking to the bottom of the ocean. And there are those who will form a culture where in their mind it never happened, nothing to remember, never happened. It was all just a made-up myth by those who were insane at that time, probably had bad nutrition. They'll figure something, they'll say, bad nutrition, suppression of women and minorities, devious control system, they'll already have all these rationales where there's really nothing to it at all. And it was just a bad thing, and it's good that it's gone. So we're not saying that. We're saying it has become very, it's stalled out, yes. It has stalled out in many ways. Some of it has stalled out. Some more than others. I mean, the stall out is more in others than, it's like on a wave, you can stall out to reposition yourself back in the barrel. Or if you stall out too much, you're going to wipe out. So stalling, you have to be very careful you don't stall out too much. Sri Sri Nandamaya told everyone, look, the path has to be brisk. You must keep it brisk every day. You don't have to go too fast, but it must be brisk. You cannot go too slow and stall out like that and become overly dogmatic. You must keep challenging your expectations. More greetings. More greetings. But I don't do anything. I do work like a dog, though. But other than that, I don't do much. I just tape. I don't interact much. Yeah. No interaction. I don't really interact with anyone. But you can see why. Because I'm really reacting with the allness, the all, the oneness. So I'm giving this to everyone. I said, this is what I desire for everyone, is they be able to live this lifestyle. They don't need to interact with me. They need to interact with the Holy Spirit. Now, if the grace of the Bird of Paradise is upon me, I can be part of that their interaction with the Holy Spirit. But really, it's our trust in the Holy Spirit is what counts. Because we can trust that far more than we can trust any appearance of a body, you see. The body could always get sick, it can go somewhere, it can leave you, this and that. The body moves around, but the Holy Spirit's always with you. It's within your mind, actually. God placed it there, created it there, to always be with us, never leave us. So it's always present as this bridge. Always present as this bridge. So here it's really the start of a new Dharmic culture right here. It's really the new way. It's really the beginning of a new Dharmic culture here. And the foundation has been worked on for a while now, right? I'm going to say the last 50 years. We've been really working on that. And more even more than that, but we've really been working on the foundation of it. And now the house begins to be seen. It's like, wow. We can live in this new Dharmic culture. We have a new Dharmic culture now. And I said, the Dharmic kings are not trying to pull me into the old Dharmic ways. And they haven't, have they? Did Longchenpa pull me into Vajrayana Buddhism? No. Because we're just using this very direct assertions as if it's true and feeling and accepting it's true for us. I cannot modify anything in any way. I'm totally incapable of ever modifying anything in any way. It's your acceptance of that, practicing your acceptance of this. This absolutely, you know, knocks out your expectations that the dream is based upon, which is modification. So, these Dharmic kings appeared to me. I said, you know, okay, but I'm not promising that I'm going to do it the old Dharmic way. I'm not promising that. I'm going to continue to do it to the purpose I came here to this new, the new way. The streamlined, you know, very simple way. And work on keeping it uncluttered. Work on keeping it uncluttered. So hopefully they can appreciate that, right? And of course, Longchenpa, I assume he appreciates that. Means that this is Dzogchen, really. I mean, it's the heart of it, actually. The apex yoga way is simply, you're already there. There's nothing you need to do at all. Just keep accepting that. There's nothing I can modify. I cannot perform any modification whatsoever. And I'm already I'm already awake. There's nothing I need to do to become awake. I'm already awake. Pretending to dream is just a perspective, it's just a perception. We're really already awake. Everyone's already awake. They're just pretending to sleep. But is pretending to sleep actual sleep? No. You're still awake. You're still awake. You're just perceiving yourself as if you were sleeping. It's just a misperception, so to speak. Jesus says all perception is misperception. That's a good one, isn't it? All perception is misperception. So again, your relationship is with the Holy Spirit. Your trust is with the Holy Spirit. It's pretty difficult to not have suspicion about each one another in this world. But the Holy Spirit is much easier to not be suspicious at all, not have a suspicious mind, know that I can trust it. It's always going to be there. It can't leave me at all. And then this enables us to have a relationship based on trust, on great trust. Ultimately, we will trust one another. But I found on the spiritual path is better for me just to go straight to the Holy Spirit. Because I feel that no matter what I say and affirmation wise, the Holy Spirit's going to be there. It's not going to shock the Holy Spirit in any way. Whereas if I was with somebody, someone here that is full of expectations, if I say I can't modify anything in any way, you know, that's going to really shock them. And they're going to say, whoa, I can't really trust you because I'm really trusting you can modify something for me. You know? So I think it would slow me down. But the Holy Spirit doesn't shock it at all. Doesn't shock its expectations at all. It's completely free of time. The Holy Spirit knows not of time at all. So I can't shock the Holy Spirit at all. So I feel free to say this and practice this way, knowing that the bird of paradise will not leave me. And so the entire world can leave me, but there's nothing in this entire world that is remotely as exquisite as the bird of paradise. So what kind of loss is it? What? It's like ice cream. You have ice cream, people say, we're going to leave you. If you eat that ice cream, we're going to leave you. And I said, well, what are you going to do? I said, we're going to go eat dirt. I said, well, I mean, what am I missing out on eating dirt? I don't think I'm missing out on anything. If you want to go eat dirt, go ahead. I still got this ice cream. I shouldn't speak of ice cream on a hot summer day. I might want to eat some, but I can't. You know, it's part of my dharmic discipline. I haven't eaten anything today. My weight is still up a little bit because, I mean, I like to eat salty chips when it's hot and salty peanuts. So that's not good. Okay, got to try not to do that. Probably I could afford to lose a pound and a half. And maybe be at my ideal weight where I'm not ultra thin and skinny and feel weak. I feel still real strong and solid, but no extra baggage. Not getting any extra baggage, about a pound and a half. Let's see if I can get that. It's going to take an effort, no doubt about it. Especially today, people are going to want to go, live it up. It's Father's Day, come on, stuff your face. So they're always saying stuff your face here, aren't they? I mean, what day do they not say stuff your face? They try to have like some excuse, everyone in this, every day to stuff your face here. And that really takes you away from your spiritual practice. It really does. You should really systematically undereat. It's very helpful. You don't want your system consumed with digesting food. You know, let the blood go to your brain, so to speak, right? Stay alert. Don't be dulled by heavy meals. Eat a sattvic diet that doesn't bog you down. Those heavy meals just turn you like you become a creature, right? You feel like you're a creature. Like, oh, I want to be like a creature. Let me eat all this, consume all this dead, those these dead animals, you know? Well, it keeps you pretending you're a creature, isn't it? Drinking alcohol, consuming dead animals, and yeah, let me reinforce my pretense that I'm a creature, and believe that the gods and goddesses are happy because that's what they really love too. I'm offering this stuff to them; that's what they want to consume also. So what I'll eat today? You know, some blueberries, some strawberries. I'll go blueberry, strawberry. Banana. Cherry juice. I'll try to do that. Maybe some lemonade. I'm just trying to go get back to the smoothies now more and more. That'll really do it. That'll work if you just drink smoothies. I put protein powder in also, so I make sure I get, you know, lots of protein. Once you start eating a lot of solid food, the craving continues. You seem to crave it. Once you get off of solid food onto smoothies, the craving disappears for solid food. Not even interested anymore. And that really helps prevent you from overeating. Because you can sip your smoothie. If you're getting hungry, just sip a little bit and then, you know, stop sipping. You don't have to, it's like a meal you got to finish. When you put a meal on your plate, you feel like you got to finish it. You know, where you got a smoothie, you just sip a little bit and put it down. It's like a water bottle. You know, no one's saying, got to finish that smoothie right now. Come on, chuck it down. Nobody's saying that. It's just a snack. You're just snacking on it. So they say it's better to snack, little bits of food, snack. This doesn't shock your body by stuffing this huge meal down your gullet, you know? It doesn't. Don't shock your body. Save the shock for going past your expectations, your spiritual expectations, your existential expectations. Not going past expectations. How much can I eat? Oh, I ate more than I expected. Wow, what a shock. You know, I grossed myself out more than I expected. You know, so grossing yourself out with physicality is not the kind of going beyond expectations that we practice here at all. That's counterproductive. Here we go beyond the expectations of true core existential expectations is what we have to focus on. I can't modify anything at all. I'm incapable of any, you could say I'm incapable of any sort of life at all, actually. I can never have a life. I can never even have the smallest, tiniest life. I can't even be an amoeba or a cell. I'm incapable of any type of life whatsoever. Because reality is really not quote-unquote life as we call it. It's eternity. It's ever new, ever fresh being. It's not the life that we think of life into at all. So we could say, I'm incapable of any type of life. I'm totally incapable of any type of life. That's another powerful one. That really will help us from waking from this dream of all these, what we call life forms. I'm totally incapable of any type of life. Now, if you're stuff on your face or, you know, sex, drugs, and rock and roll, food is a drug, isn't it? I mean, you're drugging yourself with food. You're just engrossing yourself in the belief that you have a life, that you're capable of having a life. But here we're directly asserting, I'm totally incapable of having any life at all. I can never even have the slightest life. I'm incapable of having a life. Totally incapable of having a life. I don't have any life at all. I never will. I never have and I never will have any life whatsoever. And this is the never-bornness of reality, actually, that we're really asserting. We're allowing or reshaping our expectations so that our attention can pivot. And there's the bird of paradise. We expect it. So I'm incapable of ever having even the slightest life, even the shortest life, even the most ephemeral life at all. I can't even have the most ephemeral life possible. I can't even have that in any way. I can't even be alive for the shortest nanosecond at all, in the tiniest nanoparticle. I can't even be the tiniest nanoparticle with the shortest half-life. I can't even have that in any way. I can never have even the slightest, most ephemeral life at all. Never possible for me. Totally impossible for me. Totally impossible for me. Now, desire that this be the expectation for everyone, and you're practicing is that way. You say, this is what I expect. I give this to all. And you yourself will receive that then. And we will realize that we are never, can never be confined within any boundaries at all, the boundaries we call life, no matter how ephemeral we may try to imagine them to be. We are intrinsically and always unbounded. Absolute freedom. So I can never have any life whatsoever. And I've never had any life whatsoever. And I never will have any life whatsoever. Of course, I've been a serial dreamer of many lives. A serial pretender, actually. But I've never actually had any life at all. None of us have. Not one of us has ever had any life at all, no matter how ephemeral we've tried to pretend it to be. So none of us really need to be free of any life at all. We just need to drop the pretending. The desire to pretend. There's no causation other than that we need to be look at all. So to drop pretending, we need to assert that, you know, I realize it's much ado about nothing. I can never be any life at all. I can never have any life at all. I can't have any life whatsoever. I will never have any life. And I've never had a life. I never will have a life. I don't have a life now. Completely impossible for me. Totally impossible for me. And I accept that. I accept the impossibility of me ever having any life whatsoever. I accept the impossibility of me ever having any life whatsoever. That's a strong one. I can feel that suddenly. Woof, the more muscles you have, the more they can tighten up. The less you have, the less they tighten up. But then, of course, the more feeble you feel. So we can't win with the body. We can't win, can we? We try to find that golden mean, but it's never quite right. It's never quite right. Ah, I feel kind of tight. I can't seem, the summer, it's just tight, not right, not quite right. But hey. Little cat is walking by. It can never catch the bird of paradise, the cat, because the cat doesn't expect it to be there. So the cat, it's not even there. They overlook it. And even if they didn't overlook it, they'd find that it's like in the nature of a phantom. The claws cannot grab a hold of anything. It's like air. It's there, but their claws go right through it. Now, when it perched on my hand, did I feel its feet on my hand? No, I didn't feel any feet on my hand, but I perceived that it was perched. But I didn't feel any actual contact, physical contact. I did not feel any physical contact. That's probably wise to note. So, the wow is here from that latest affirmation. I mean, it's impossible for me to ever have any life whatsoever. The wow is there from that, so I'm, expecting the wow. It's there. I said, great. Okay, so consciously be aware. Okay, I'm experiencing the wow. That's what I expect to experience. Great. No problems here. So don't wallow in any reactions, emotions. Do not wallow in any emotions, okay? Do not waddle in any feeling, emotion, motion feeling, okay, at all. Stick right with the shock of wow. Just stay, I'm just sticking just with that, nothing else. No elaboration upon it. Because if we expect just that, it's easy, easy, easy. No problem at all. Just breeze right through it. Breeze right through the shock. As soon as you start to elaborate on it, you start to fall towards panic. You start to make it complex. And then you start saying, well, it's not quite what I expect. I'm not sure. Help, my expectations aren't being met. I'm not sure. And then you will start to go into panic. And then you will begin to fixate back on your old expectations. You'll try a way to reconstitute your old expectations. And then the benefit of the practice is nullified. It's nullified. And then you feel very frustrated. You say, I worked so hard to make progress and I lost all my progress. What's going on, Holy Spirit? How come? Blah, 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 blah. And then you get all frustrated with the Holy Spirit because you're not practicing properly. You're not heeding the advice. You have just one expectation that you're going to feel this wow, the shock of wow, mixture of elation, trepidation. You do not elaborate on it at all. Just the wow, nothing other than that. When you do that, you say, well, that's so easy. And the catch is, you might get frightened and say, well, that's so easy. I can't fail. I'm going to succeed at this path. There's no doubt about it. And then you may panic because you may not want to succeed. But if you keep using this wow, you will find yourself getting comfortable with success. So that's the flip side. Okay. You have to decide, you have to realize that this boogeyman of success, you gradually, it vanishes gradually, because you get comfortable. It's just normal to you. You say, what's the big deal? I expect this. I expect the bird of paradise to show up. So it's not too much of a shock for me at all. That's because you've gradually lessened the shock of that. Change your expectations. So understand that for sure, success is the ultimate boogeyman. But as you gradually get used to it like this, it becomes less and less and less and less so. Less and less and less so. And that's what we have to do. Otherwise, it will remain a boogeyman, and you'll be right back in your old expectations, trying to forget all about reality, thinking it's possible. And getting so frustrated with God, and ultimately saying, I can't tolerate this frustration, and deciding to forget all about it as if it never was. And then you become part of the crowd that believes it was all just a myth, it was all a lie, and we best forget all about it. And before you know it, you're enmeshed in that culture, the non-dharmic culture. You're going to be enmeshed in one culture or the other, that's for sure. You either have enmeshed in a dharmic culture or a non-dharmic culture. There isn't any other option at all, because both are going in opposite directions. They both have a goal. Non-dharmic culture is to forget, believing you can totally forget about reality forever, and dharmic culture is to realize that you're already awake, and you can set down your pretending, and it's your awakeness is already there. Okay, so they both have absolute goals that they're rapidly going towards. So there's no way to stand in the middle. You'll just oscillate with confusion if you try to do that. Because these are directions that with aims, you know, really, that you're really going very briskly towards. And you can just try to stall out in one of these two paths, but then you'll just feel like in a stall out, and you feel like lost and miserable. And so you might say you can say you have a path of misery, but that gets old quickly. Because like I say, I don't have any direction at all. I'm just miserable. I'll just be miserable all the time. I tried that, and I was just miserable all the time. That's all. That's all it is. And that ultimately, you ultimately try to get free of that by total mental chaos, and that's just like the essence of misery. And then you realize that I can't stay in the essence of misery. I just cannot. It feels completely alien to me, so I cannot stay with this. And then you realize the non-path of misery can't do it. I gotta decide which, either dharmic or non-dharmic. Gotta have a direction. Got to have a practice. Got to have a focus for my attention. And, you know, the dharmic way is to say that, you know, that I can never take a path at all, which is true. But that's still a focus for your attention, isn't it? It's a practice. I can never have any path at all. I can never have any direction at all. That itself, for the sake of practicing, is a direction. It's a direction of waking up, of realizing you're already awake, and that I'm just pretending. So it is a trending towards that, we would say. So don't, if you think you're trying to stall out, don't think that it's some sort of stall out. It's not. It's not. And those who want to stall out will argue about level, get into a level confusion debate, which they're really just saying, I don't want to be dharmic and I don't want to be non-dharmic. So do you have something for me? Well, what you have would be continual misery. And some are just trying to say, but can you make me happy in continual misery? No. Denying happiness is misery, and so you won't be happy. No, we can't do the impossible. That would be what you're saying is, can you not divide my mind? So part of my mind is in constant misery, another part of my mind is happy. Well, no, you can't divide the mind. All you could do is oscillate between the two, which is really the worst misery of all. It really is. There's no greater, worse misery than oscillating between happiness and misery, because that brings in the extreme frustration, extreme despair. So we're rapidly gaining acceptance. We're rapidly reshaping our expectations. Now, if you want to call that a path or a direction or whatever, yeah, sure. It's an endeavor, you might say. It's a sadhana. It's a spiritual discipline. Yeah, we cannot dispense with spiritual discipline. So that's Dharmic culture. Call it whatever you want. It's still a necessity. You can't somehow trick yourself out of it with words. It's not possible. So why even bother? And the other, non-dharmic, is just total forgetfulness. Trying to say that we can make reality abnormal, which would be a total forgetfulness of reality, actually. Because it's all one, reality's all one. You'd have to be abnormal, we would have to totally forget all of reality forever. And so that's what really their goal is. They think they believe they can accomplish that, or they want to try to accomplish it. That's a non-dharmic culture. You know, so it's a stuff your face culture. Just stuff your face with, you know, sensations and physicality. Stuff your face with physicality. How do you hit a 3-wood 300 yards? I guess that's what happened yesterday. Now, off the tee, which is immaculately prepared, level and prepared, and short grass, etc., I could understand you could hit it perfectly. But off the fairway, you know, where it's not necessarily going to be an even lie at all, and the grass is not even, and I mean, there's different conditions. Hit it 300 yards and dead on the flag and end up 8 feet away from the flag, 300 yards away. I mean, how do you do that under U.S. Open pressure? Wow. I tell you what, you have to expect that you can do it. Right? You have to expect. But even expecting to forget reality, no matter how much you expect you can do that, it makes no difference. You can't do it. So trying to build the expectations that we can accomplish the impossible is we're really just building misery, because we will probably go through this oscillation and say, well, I don't really want to let go of this, so can I have both dharmic culture and non-dharmic? What you get then is misery. So most non-dharmic, those who are in non-dharmic culture embracing it, they're not acutely miserable. They're subacutely miserable. They can always kick the can of misery down the road a little bit. But if you decide, no, I want both dharmic and non-dharmic, I don't want to totally forget about reality, but I don't really want to totally remember about reality, I want something that's neither, then you go into acute misery. You're miserable, acutely miserable all the time. And then you go into therapy. You can't avoid it. You say, I can't take this anymore. I got to get help. So then you go into some therapy. Now, if you go into non-dharmic therapy, they'll track you back and say, well, just be non-dharmic. You can just enjoy your life. Come on. Enjoy the food. Eat food. Eat what you love. Do what you love. Do this, whatever. You know, if you like it, do it. If it feels good, do it. You can go back into non-dharmic culture. And then you stop feeling acutely miserable. Or you can have dharmic therapy when you start doing your actual spiritual practice on your expectations, and that too, you won't be acutely miserable anymore. The difference is, in dharmic culture, you go towards dropping all misery forever, whereas in non-dharmic culture, you just kick the can of misery down the road over and over and over and over and over until you get so absolutely bored with it you can't tolerate it anymore. It becomes hideous, and then you go back into acute misery. And you just can repeat that cycle over and over and over. So you're not really trending towards getting free of misery at all. You're just trying to dull it a little bit. It's not quite as acute. You know, so that's not really very attractive, is it? It's funny, I don't have a single friend now that I can stay with. But in the future, at some point, maybe there'll be people fighting over having me stay with them. Multitudes. So you gotta stay with me. You gotta stay with me. You gotta see how clever I've been. You gotta see how nice my house is. Come on. Which is a real pain. I'd rather have it where there's nowhere to stay than have everybody, you know, fighting over you, you know, competing to get you to stay with them. Really. I that's really distracting. And out of my mom, she stopped doing that. She just stayed in an ashram. She wouldn't stay in anyone's home after a while. They were competing. It was a distraction. Their attention was getting her to stay with them instead of on their own spiritual practice. That's what happened. So she then refused to stay with anyone. Because everyone became too envious. Why did you stay with them? What about them that you like better? You know, oh, maybe we need to make our house this way or that way. And they became very competitive over that. So she would refuse to enter a householder's house. She would stay with in an ashram of those who are nunciates. But in the early days, she did. She did stay in homes. And they would invite her. Of course, it gave the motivation to, you know, to really make sure that their home, you know, is very dharmic. But it could easily dissolve into just show. You know, anybody can spruce their house up for important VIP guests, but are they really dharmic in their heart continuously? Your house could be extraordinarily simple. If you're truly dharmic, you're not house proud, actually. You're not house proud, you're not yard proud. Just all you need is a little bench like I have here. And just to work at it. You don't need some elaborate shrine. There's so many elaborate shrines in homes. Each one tries to outdo themselves, how elaborate their shrine is, how beautifully this shrine is dressed up, and how elaborate the rituals are. You know? You don't need that. The shrine is in your mind, actually. Your practice is your shrine, actually. I have a glorious shrine of practice. That's my shrine. I don't need any external shrine. I don't need any external rituals. This wow practice is the ritual. And it's effective. That's all we need is an effective practice. That's our ritual. So, very simple culture can be very plain, very simple culture. We don't need all the elaborations here in the new way, in the new Dharmic culture. We don't need all those elaborations. We don't need the gaudiness of it all. It's funny that Gaudi, I think the Spanish architect Gaudi, was so gaudy. Had the right name for it. Doctors' names are always funny. It's funny how names tend to suit the people, you know, suit people. I've always noticed that and say, how does that work? Dr. Bones or something. Dr. Payne. I mean, are you going to go see Dr. Payne? P-A-Y-N-E or P-A-I-N-E? Dr. Payne. Hi, I'm Dr. Payne. They might say, well, you understand pain, don't you, Doc? And now you need to give me something for my pain. I really need something for my pain. Sure, sure, sure. I'll get you something for your pain. If we say, well, we can't handle Dharmic culture, you know, we'd be in so much pain. Well, the cultures beforehand handled Dharmic culture very well. They're a lot happier than we are, that's for sure. You know, expectations are all powerful in terms of our perception, even our physicality of experiencing pain and all that. You can reshape those expectations to the point where you're not going to physically suffer the way we're physically suffering now. People are suffering now worse than they ever suffered. They really are. It's amazing, people, the different perceptions of pain, I've noticed. Some people that you think, oh man, they've been through all this hell, chemotherapy, they've just been through hell, I would think. And they don't feel sorry for self, at least, but say, oh, I'm fine, I feel good, yeah, not, no problem. How was it? Oh, it's okay, you know. I felt a little ill, but not much. And then, what? Other people, they'll just be like, it was hideous for them. So, pain is very much based on our expectations and perception. In fact, Jesus says 100% based on it. So in a Dharmic culture, you know, we don't have to have this elaborate healthcare system that we have now. And out of my mind, they'd call her. Someone was, you know, at death's door. And she would come and she'd say, okay, this is what I want you to do. Just do this practice, just this, and you'll get well in a while, okay? That's it. And they do it and they get well. Why? Because what she asked them to do is start reshaping this expectation. She could tell which, you know, what expectation or constellation of expectations is most important, relevant to work, to reshape in order for this illness to not appear. Not to expect it to appear. It appears because we expect it to appear. And it would, in a while, it would just vanish. It would just go away. That's all there is to it. That's all there is to it. That's all there is to any medicine or healing at all, is expectations. That's all there is. Because it's 100% pretense. So we have to expect to not pretend in that way. And then that illness will just vanish. I should give them a flower and say, here, just every time you look at this flower, put it in a vase and look at it and remember me as you look at it. Bring me to mind. Bring me into mind when you look at that flower or something like that. And do this as much as you can. They would. They get well. So she didn't have any set way of treating anyone at all. It just depends on their overall constellation of expectations. And she would use whatever is appropriate or suitable for that, then she would just utilize that. Or if it was beneficial for them to actually stay ill and die, in terms of that they've chosen that as a way to reshape their expectations profoundly in some way that is dharmically helpful, then she would go along with that too. Because that's also a possibility. And sometimes affliction is our great greatest friend here. So if that's true, then she would say, well, you know what? Just let the affliction be. It's helping you. And it'll help you focus on being really more serious about, you know, your spiritual practice. So it's beneficial for you to have this affliction. And so leave it at that. That's a real doctor, isn't it? That's a true spiritual doctor right there. And so the expectations that we had, for instance, of cancer, that it's uncured, you can't cure it really, back then, those were the expectations. It's a death sentence. So she allowed herself to get cancer to play with our expectations about around cancer. And again, I told this story a number of times, how she had the best doctor, the head of the best hospital in India, basically. He took her on as her patient, said, I'm going to treat you. I'm going to do everything I can to help you. The most modern scientific, everything. I'm personally in charge of your cancer and treating it. And he had a team of physicians and nurses at disposal. And she said, I don't need any treatment at all. She says, well, I'm gonna be here for you. She goes, well, okay, but I don't need any treatment. And so her cancer metastasized throughout her body. So it was everywhere, lumps, tumors everywhere. And the doctor said, I've never seen such a bad case of cancer in all my life. It's the worst I've ever seen by far. He says, I don't know how you can tolerate the pain. It must be the most painful experience anyone's ever had. And she says, I don't feel a thing. I feel perfect. And she goes, well, you're lying. He says, no, I feel perfect. He says, well, I'm going to give you morphine. And she goes, no, I don't need anything. I feel perfect. No, I don't feel any different than I ever feel. Nothing. What's wrong? There's nothing wrong with me. And he said, well, you're in denial. I don't understand it. So he waited until he thought she was asleep. And he snuck down into a room with a syringe of morphine and was sneaking up on her. And suddenly she sat upright in a yoga asana, and he said he saw this amazing flash of light in all directions come from her, and it shocked him so bad he fled. And that when he came back in the morning, she was sitting there, and he was shaking because he was checking on her. He says, is she still alive? I'm sure she must be dead. Something horrible happened. And she welcomed him, and she was radiantly blissful. And he checked her out, and there was not a trace of cancer, no tumor in her body at all. It all completely vanished from when he had seen her the day previously. And then he finally said, what happened? And she said, well, I saw you come in my room to give me morphine, and I realized at that time it was appropriate for the cancer to leave, and so it left me. I had no more expectation that it be present, and poof, gone. And she said, I saw some form leave me and leap over the balcony and run along the Ganges River and disappear, so to speak. So she gave it some structure to it leaving, so that meet our expectations, well, that something left you. But it was really, she said, it was really instantaneous. It all left my body instantaneously. So by doing that, that changed our expectations about cancer, didn't it? Because the doctor said, oh, wow, it's true. It's totally vanished. And so that created a tremendous buzz, you know, like, hey, this is possible. This is possible. Cancer can leave us. So she did this with all sorts of illnesses. She gets sick because we expect that nothing we could do about this, and then it would vanish. She said, when the time comes for it to go, it will simply go. And that's what happened. It would simply go. And not without a trace. Gone. Without a trace. So we have to retool our expectations around this. No treatment. She said, I don't need any treatment. So she took on the so-called our expectations. Jesus took on the suffering of the world, meaning he took on the expectations of the world as far as healing others. But she literally got sick herself. She actually manifested the sickness in her body to say, look, I've got you the sickness that you expect to have, and now I'm going to show you that if you work on your expectations enough, it will simply vanish. It will go away without a trace. She said, it's all about your spiritual practice, reshaping what you expect, reshaping the expectations of your mind, of your attention, of your mind. That's what you need to do. And you can take whatever medicine you expect to take, etc. But do not stop your spiritual practice. And you will find, as you keep your spiritual practice going, you will find that you lose interest in the medicine. You realize at some point, you say, I don't really need that anymore. I don't really need that anymore. Well, you shouldn't force the issue about stopping any sort of medicine. You shouldn't force that issue. She never said stop any medicine or don't do this. Rarely, I would say. But just do the spiritual practice, reshape your expectations, and you'll be fine. Oftentimes she didn't offer instantaneous healing. She because she realized that you need to reshape your expectations. So work at it every day and increase how much time you spend at it and effort. Increase it. Keep doing it. Keep doing it. And of course, it's a great, when you're ill, it's a motivation to do something about it. Most people. But today, that motivation has been removed by we just simply go to the doctor and get pills, get drugs. That's all. I mean, people get sick these days. It doesn't even make an impression upon them. When I have a problem, it makes a great impression upon me because I can't rely on doctors. So I realize something in my mind, I have to work on something in my mind. There's no other way. Whereas these days, people never even occurs to them that there could be some expectation in their mind that's causing this. It never occurs to them. They just say, I don't know, I just got sick. I have no idea why. I'll go to the doctor. He'll give me some drugs, and that's it. That's all I can do. That's an extremely non-dharmic culture we have right now. Extremely. Healthcare is all important in culture. How your healthcare system is how your culture is going to be. And we have an extremely, extraordinarily non-dharmic healthcare system now. And there are, of course, some who are trying to play the middle ground, who don't want to commit to a dharmic culture, but don't really like the non-dharmic culture either. And they kind of muddy the waters. They've muddied the waters. So we really can't see a true dharmic culture for what it is. A true dharmic culture doesn't attack non-dharmic culture. It just says, do this spiritual practice. And gradually you will lose interest in a non-dharmic culture. You will lose interest. It doesn't try to have its cake and eat it too, and have a spiritualized culture, which is this in-between misery sort of thing. Let's do some Ayurvedic, and let's do this too, but let's also use the drugs, and it's still medicine. Okay? A real dharmic culture ultimately dispenses with all medicine. All palliative sort of treatments at all. It's 100% reshaping our expectations. 100%, it's trending towards 100% that. Whereas this sort of in-between culture that we have now, the spiritualized, non-dharmic spiritualized culture, is all about palliative stuff. You know, it's just that, but it's not as harsh as these other drugs, you know. They've got this homeopathic remedy that will work for you, this allopathic this and this. It's still, I mean, they got more treatments than the harsh medical healthcare system do, don't they? The never-ending treatments. Whereas true dharmic culture is your spiritual practice is the treatment. Very simple. It's extremely simple. But you see people now, they got, you know, potions and lotions and pillbox vials and flasks. And I mean, there's no room for in their bedroom and kitchen and bathroom for all this stuff. Whereas at least the hardcore non-dharmic ones, they just got some, you know, painkiller, some Oxycontin or something, Percocet or something, or some Xanax. You know, I just got this one pill, but I got Xanax, I just pop it, you know. But that's it. Whereas the others are trying to have it both ways. I mean, that's a never-ending thing. They just have everything constantly getting more and more and more and more and more. I'm taking, you know, 50 vitamins, and I'm taking this, and I'm doing this treatment here and this treatment. They're obsessed with treatment. Fanatically obsessed by it, because they're really in misery. Actually, they're in psychological misery, trying to have it both ways. Say, so maybe I can get the best of both worlds. I can forget about reality, but get a really happy forgetfulness of reality. I can still stay light and ephemeral. I can have a light ephemeral life. I can have a life, but it can be light and ephemeral. Okay, and so then they get obsessed with the lotions and the potions and the pill, the non-harsh pills and all this treatments. Obsessed by it. That's horrible. That's even worse. You know, that's the worst. So you have to come out of that one way or the other. And some come out of it, go back to the non-dharmic, and some come out of it in the dharmic culture. But in no way is a dharmic culture advocating all that stuff. In no way. It's not inviting all the elaborations. Just the opposite. It's inviting stark simplicity. Inviting stark simplicity. This very simple practice in a very starkly simplistic setting. That's a real treatment. That's what actually works. And the fact that it works is quite shocking to us, because we're used to taking stuff that's pretending to work, but deep down we know it won't really work. We just hope the pretense will be like have its own causation, so we don't have to keep pretending. We want pretending to be independently causative, and it never is. We keep thinking, we just take this non-harsh allopathic, Ayurvedic stuff, and that will cause this pretending to be automatic on its own. It'll be healthy pretending that has a separate causation from our own mind, and then we'll be happy. We'll be happy. So it's still an attempt to structure this independent causation of pretense to make it real. It's just doing it in what it thinks is a more clever way than just this heavy-handed, non-dharmic healthcare system. Yeah, let's do surgery. Cut it out. No, we're going to treat it. Let's treat it with a lavender essence and inhaling, and this inhaling scents and tones. We'll have all this tone healing, Listen to these tones. Oh, that really tones about my etheric body and all this stuff. That's even worse. That's even more delusional. What you're saying is we can be clever enough to make pretension real. And then when we do make pretension real, we'll realize our own cleverness, and then we'll be happy because we'll be so proud of our supreme cleverness. We did it. We did something even God can't do. And we think our happiness will come from that. So forget about all that New Age healing stuff. Unless you're already into it, in which case, just stay with what you're used to, and then put all your attention onto reshaping your expectations the way we're doing here. Like, I can never have any life at all. I can never be even the slightest bit clever. I can never have any life whatsoever. Not an ephemeral life, no life at all. I can never have any life at all. Wow. And just your expectation is wow. It's that simple. No elaboration on your expectation at all. It's just wow. You're going to, when you practice, you're just going to experience this one experience of wow. And when you do that, you're being dharmic. Welcome to Dharmic culture. Welcome to Dharmic culture. Welcome to Dharmic culture. Can I get that in the picture? I will now put the welcome, see if I get the welcome sign in there. Well, there you go. Welcome to Dharmic culture. There you go. Welcome to Dharmic culture. I probably pushed it too far there. Yeah, push it up just a little bit. Yeah, not enough. Okay, that should do it. Welcome to Dharmic culture. Welcome to Dharmic culture. You're very welcome here. It's very easy to be part of it, isn't it? Because it's still not enough. Because that's all you have to do is this very simple practice without elaborations. You don't have to elaborate upon it. You don't have to elaborate upon it. Whatever elaborations you do will be starkly simple. It's still the same format. The affirmations may be different as you keep searching for what expectation you need to reshape. But the shock and the expectation of wow and blocking the panic, that's all the same. No matter what affirmation you make, that stays the same. It 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 stays tremendously simple. There you go. There's a full welcome there. See, I just had to reshape my expectations. See, I did it like how many times? Maybe 8 times, a lot, right? Did a lot there. And finally I got it fully in the picture just right. So don't give up. Keep reshaping your expectations. Keep welcoming yourself to Dharmic culture. Keep welcoming yourself. Whatever you're doing that's normal for you, just stay with it. But stop elaborating upon it. And turn to Dharmic culture and practice. Even if you're drinking coffee, just stay with it. Don't elaborate upon it, though. Be bored with it. Gradually you lose interest in it. Gradually you realize, don't increase it. You don't try to push things with it. Because you're already bored with your life, right? So just stay bored with it. Don't introduce a whole bunch of elaborations at all. Stay bored with it. And just turn to the simple practice and say, I can never have it. Life is impossible for me. I can never have any life at all. I can never have any life at all. Wow. And don't elaborate on your reaction. It's just wow. Do not elaborate on your reaction at all. Do not jump into the ocean of samsara, of elaboration, emotional elaboration, reactional elaboration. I have one reaction, and it's just wow. That's it. Just stick with that, stick with it, stick with it, stick with it, stick with it. And you'll be able someday to make these affirmations and accept them, and you'll feel the burn of this. And one day you'll pivot your attention, and there the bird of paradise is right there. It's right there for you. Also, you say, oh, wow, out of nowhere, it's there. Well, it's always been there. It's just we stop pretending there's a nowhere. There's only an everywhere. There's just one everywhereness. There's just one everywhereness. Ah, nice breeze today. It's not bad. But, oh, I see the moon up in the sky at 12:30. A half moon there in the sky. Nice. How about that? It may be that the hot air is rising so much that it's causing convection breezes. That's probably what's happening. But once the sun gets a little lower and it's not heating the air quite as much as directly overhead, then those convection breezes will stop. Right, and it'll be a uniform heat sort of, and that's why it's like at 3, 4, 5 o'clock you feel that oppressive heat without a breeze. Again, the convection currents of rising hot air cease. Because right now at noon, the sun's really blazing overhead. It's got some convection currents going on with the rising hot air. Getting this very strong tingling again in my nose. Sometimes this happens. It's like super itchy and tingling. Wow. It's trying to trigger a sneeze. It's very intense. Now this can happen to you. You can get this reaction in some way of itching, of tingling or something. But don't try to seek that. I never try to seek it. Sometimes it just comes on. Not always. Only once in a while. A couple days ago it came on my face in the most extreme way. Don't do anything about it. Don't itch it. Don't scratch it. Wow. And you think there must be a bug there or something, but there isn't. Now the tingling suddenly shifted. Wow. It feels like there's a bug crawling around my nose, but there isn't. I hope. So. I don't think I have any. It's. Do I have any Kleenex? I don't think so. No. Very intense. How are we doing here?
Yeah.
Haven't even reached 3 hours. So welcome to Dharmic Culture here. You don't have to revamp your life first. Start practicing first. And ultimately, you'll simplify your life. That stuff just won't interest you anymore. You'll just ultimately, don't try to simplify it first. That's putting things backwards. You're trying to put on a show, a ritual, a show. Oh, you want my house, want me to simple? Okay, let me simplify. Is that it? Is that Dharmic Culture? No. Practice is Dharmic Culture. Simple, unelaborated practice. So practice first, and just stay, let everything else be the way it is. Just pay attention to pivoting your attention to the fact you're already awake to these assertions, expecting the wow reaction which arises. Just do this practice, and automatically you will just kind of lose interest in too much elaboration, really. You'll still keep a little bit of it. Won't completely dry up. You don't have to be a fanatic about it. You know, you'll still have some clothes, and you'll still have some food, and you'll still have some stuff. But the notion of chasing after elaborate emotional reactions is just not interested. You become less and less interested in that. So you're not caught up in that ocean. You might walk along the beach, but you're not caught up in the ocean. You don't go out in the ocean. Just stay on the beach. Oh, I'll have some Greek yogurt this morning. Strawberries, banana, blueberries, some locally sourced organic honey, and some 0% fat Greek yogurt. Zero fat Greek yogurt. And that's a nice low-cal, actually, high-protein breakfast. I could actually sprinkle protein powder on it and mix the yogurt in with that. Yeah, I could do that. So getting, you know, like 45 grams of protein or something from it. Keep some sort of muscularity some of with the protein. Don't want to become oversensitive, overly skinny, overly sensitive. We're not striving to be artists here, okay? Let the bird of paradise be your artist. Let that be your art. Let the inexpressible, indescribable be your art. Be your music. Be your art, yeah. Everyone can have this, so why not desire that for everyone? And you will receive it yourself. Let reality be your art. Instead of pretending an abnormal reality to be the vulnerability of beauty, trying to make the vulnerability of beauty be your art. You know? That's what, right? Don't say, well, I have to have vulnerability of beauty, you know, but I just want to make that more beautiful. I mean, it just doesn't quite satisfy me. So can you rework it a little bit and make it more beautiful for me? No. You'll still be dissatisfied. We just wasted our time. So go for the inexpressible, indescribable, invulnerable beauty of the bird of paradise. Go for that. Make that your goal. And you don't have to abandon art, but you'll just be less interested in it, actually. You know, I did all these really beautiful graphics that I thought was so wonderful for me, but now I'm kind of like, I'm not really interested in that anymore. I did all sorts of music. I went through a music phase. I made all sorts of really fabulous music that I loved. But then I said, I'm not really interested in anymore. Graphics, you know, so I've been through all sorts of stupendously beautiful stuff that I created myself. It was very creative. But now it's kind of like blah, blah, you know. What do they say? Eh, meh. The young people say meh, you know. Oh, like, meh, that's not really into it. That's not it. Didn't really do the job, did it? Still, everything's still vulnerable. All beauty's still vulnerable. Oh my gosh, that's terrible. I feel terrible. What building in history has been invulnerable? I mean, you go back, go to Greece, you look at the Acropolis and everything. I mean, you know, people say, oh, it's so beautiful, but you know what? It's vulnerable to earthquakes, to marauders, to people who want to, you know, tear it down and doesn't meet their expectations. And I mean, right? What beauty in this world is truly invulnerable, truly invulnerable? I mean, you can cut diamonds, right? Use diamonds to cut diamonds, and you can lose the diamond. Right? Somebody can attack you, steal it from you, pillage you, and take your diamond away. And it can be cut into many smaller diamonds and even end up as some industrial grit on some grinding disc, you know? So what beauty here is truly invulnerable? We look at the sky, but we say we can pollute the sky, right? You look at the landscape, and we can clear cut the landscape. You know, the rivers, we can pollute them. So what beauty here in this world is truly invulnerable? And is that what we really want? Are we going to be satisfied with vulnerable beauty? We all know the answer to that, don't we? Deep down, it's like, it's never going to satisfy us. We're always going to feel insecure, fearful, and defensive. We have to defend our, you know, I got this beauty, but it's defended. Oh, I have this beautiful yard. Drought came, you know. Had to stop watering so much stuff died. Or the climate change and the stuff doesn't grow properly. I ran out of money, or I got tired tending to it, and or some pests came in, you know, and gopher came and destroyed it. And I always had this feeling of stress and vulnerability. No matter how many beautiful, maybe I forgot to water, or maybe the water, you know, lost electricity, the water system didn't work right, or it broke, or it's getting too much, or, you know, something's not, doesn't like where it is. And you're constantly feeling this vulnerability to all this beautiful flowers. It's horrible. I was miserable. I don't know if I've ever been as miserable as trying to keep a beautiful landscape going. Just flowers everywhere. It was just like, I felt so nervous. I'm going to lose it. What if I lose it? What if it dies? What if I forget? What's going to happen? I'm going to lose this beauty. Yeah, it's beautiful, but it's not secure. So I was miserable. Winter comes. It's going to kill everything. It's horrible. How do I protect it from winter? You know, I pray for a mild winter, but it wasn't mild enough. So, really, trying to beautify this world and fix up this world is really, you might say, the worst hell of all. It just let it be just the way it is. That's way less hell. Even the trees we have, they're always changing. We know they're going to die at some point. You know, a storm can knock them down. I mean, we tend to look at trees like you're always going to be there, but not necessarily, really. They break, the windstorm can cause them damage. They can get boar beetle. A lot of trees here are getting boar beetles and dying. Climate change, shifting, You get new insects and new parasites and stuff. It's always changing, this world. And the beauty here is never invulnerable. What a hideous dream, right? What a hideous pretense. Torturing ourselves, really. And then you're outside enjoying the beauty and the mosquitoes are biting you. Or the flies are biting you. Like a little flies bother me. It's like, okay, it's time for flies to show up, right? Ah, oh, it's so nice. Is it night or day? Oh, fly, you know. It's bugging me. It's been called bug. Hey, stop bugging me. All these bugs are around. Nice cameo, fly. Just at the right time. So it's heating up, not oppressive at this point, but it's warming up. Probably, you know, just be mid-90s today, but it doesn't feel bad. Probably it's not going to get too much hotter than this here. So it's not really a heat wave, it's a warm wave. It's a wave of warmness. Heat is when it gets over 100. That's a heat wave, when you're talking about over 100. 103, 104, 105, 101, you know, when it stays above 100 for a number of days, then you're going to feel like, yeah, that was a heat wave. I miss heat waves. We don't get them as much as we used to. We used to get them almost every summer, there'd be heat waves. Now, we don't get them. I love heat waves. I used to live for heat waves. I just love them. So, I miss the heat waves. Global leveling out, you know. How come we don't get the heat waves anymore? But they're getting one down southwest now, but really, they're used to that. They get those quite frequently. We could have a cold wave come. Yeah, actually, we won't get into that. The flip side of global warming is actual global cooling. Believe it or not, abnormal global cooling. You could say changed weather, actually. Changed weather. Redistributed weather. Change in weather patterns. Which could be problematical for sure. The turbulent in this world. Turbulence. Again, we started the video out. We're talking about turbulence, a dream of turbulence, and how I just lost interest in trying to fix it. And then instead turned, and there was the bird of paradise, right? Wow. So that's what I wish, that's my desire, my heartfelt desire for everyone throughout the whole universe, all universes, where dream of boundaries, pretending to be boundaries, limitations, is that they stop trying to fix anything and pivot their attention to this bird of paradise there, which is the bridge to really, truly experiencing with not any pretense of limitations in any way. And when you stop pretending, then where is there a pretend world that needs fixing? When we stop pretending that there's a pretend world that's pretending to need pretend fixing, where is there a pretend? Then where is there a pretend world that's pretending that's a pretend problem that needs pretend fixing? Where is it when we stop pretending? Where's the problem at that point? There's some metal expanding there, made a noise. So it's heating up if the metal makes a noise expanding. Where is the problem? Where is the problem then? Where is the problem then? Oh, if you want a problem, you got to go back to pretending. Otherwise, we don't go back to pretending. and we're truly enjoying then our isness, the allness, truly enjoying the allness, the oneness. Those insects can smell the sweat, they can sense it. If you start sweating, it gives off some sort of aroma that is diffused through the atmosphere, and those insects, they smell it. I can smell sweat. There's some, there's somebody, somehow, something hot-blooded there that is sweating. Let me go visit that. In real dry climate, you tend not to be bothered by the bugs as much because there's no sweat. So if you can just ease off the fixation of trying to fix everything, or fix a lot of stuff, and practice, you're now welcome to Dharmic culture. But you do have to ease off that fixation. You have to make a decision of the direction you're going to go. And it's, you know, it can be a decision is like, wow, it's really consequential, you realize. Yeah, but you'll go great. You'll go at your own pace. Might go real fast for a while, then ease up a bit, then steady it out. You know, you ultimately what you want is brisk but steady, brisk but steady. Ultimately, that's that can take a lot of doing to get to that. And most people, they'll throw themselves into it for a month or two, and then they'll back off, and it's very erratic. But what you want is brisk but steady. And I'm showcasing this here by just steady taping, unless I get asked to something that I need to attend to make it, like before the shift into the new way, I was asked to stop taping for a little while. So I really had to focus on this shift into the new way. Like a half step backwards to take a leap forward. But usually I'm taping every day, but even though I didn't tape, I was still practicing dharmically every day, absolutely. Just in a slightly different way. And I needed to have the promise fulfilled that if I did this work, I would get great beauty, and I did. And so I say, wow, Holy Spirit keeps His promises. So I can then go forward with confidence that the promise that it's making to us now, which is that it's going to get even better for us, will be kept as well. So I needed sort of a motivation to make this leap. I sort of need to be motivated. I wanted a vacation. I wanted to feel, you know, like there's some powerful motivation. And it was given to me. It was just like better than expected. Really better than expected. Way better. It was like, wow. It's amazing. And so I said, okay, let's go for it. I'll push this new way, you know, bring it, help birth the new way here. And because I was rewarded for being willing to do it. I want to be sure that we're not going to leave the world behind entirely, right? And we don't need to triumph and leave it behind and attack it or anything like that. We can still allow just the framework of it to still kind of hang around abstractly, sure. Functional bliss. Going between functional bliss and being absorbed in bliss, which is still functional bliss because you're able to be functional from that. And it's obvious that you're just spending some time in absorption like that. But you haven't really detached. It's not a feeling like you're just super distantly detached from everything here. You still feel that the presence is here, but you're just absorbed in the bliss. So that's a facet of functional bliss. And again, don't fake it. Stop faking it. The spirituality culture is a fake. Faking is trying to fake this. Don't fake it. Just start working on it, okay? And someone's probably going to call me here and say, hey. And anyway, yeah, this is a good time to say that's it. Very great. Still full stop in the wow.